Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. The Third Reich in Power by Richard J. Evans. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Preface. This book tells the story of the Third Reich, the regime created in Germany by Hitler and his National Socialists. From the moment when it completed its seizure of power in the summer of 1933, to the point when it plunged Europe into the Second World War at the beginning of September 1939. It follows an earlier volume, The Coming of the Third Reich, which told the story of the origins of Nazism, analyzed the development of its ideas, and recounted its rise to power during the years of the ill-fated Weimar Republic. A third volume, The Third Reich at War, will follow in due course, covering the period from September 1939 to May 1945, and exploring the legacy of Nazism in Europe and the world in the rest of the 20th century and on to the present. The general approach of all three volumes is set out in the preface of The Coming of the Third Reich and does not need to be repeated in detail here. Those who have already read that book and listened to the audiobook can go straight to the beginning of the first chapter of this one. But some readers might like to be reminded of the central arguments of the earlier volume, and those who have not read it may wish to turn to the prologue, which sketches the main lines of what happened before the end of June 1933, when the story told in the following pages begins. The approach adopted in the present book is necessarily thematic, but within each chapter I have tried, as in the previous volume, to mix narrative, description, and analysis, and to chart the rapidly changing situation as it unfolded over time. The Third Reich was not a static or monolithic dictatorship. It was dynamic and fast-moving, consumed from the outset by visceral hatreds and ambitions. Dominating everything was the drive to war, a war that Hitler and the Nazis saw as leading to the German racial reordering of Central and Eastern Europe, and the reemergence of Germany as the dominant power on the European continent, and beyond that, the world. In each of the following chapters, dealing in turn with policing and repression, culture and propaganda, religion and education, economy, society and everyday life, racial policy and anti-Semitism, and foreign policy, the overriding imperative of preparing Germany and its people for a major war emerges clearly as the common thread. But that imperative was neither rational in itself nor followed in a coherent way. In one area after another, the contradictions and inner irrationalities of the regime emerge. The Nazis' headlong rush to war contained the seeds of the Third Reich's eventual destruction. How and why this should be so is one of the major questions that run through this audiobook and bind its separate parts together. So, too, do many further questions about the extent to which the Third Reich won over the German people, the manner in which it worked, the degree to which Hitler, rather than broader, systematic factors inherent in the structure of the Third Reich as a whole, drove policy onwards. The possibilities of opposition, resistance, dissent, or even nonconformity to the dictates of National Socialism under a dictatorship that claimed the total allegiance of all its citizens. The nature of the Third Reich's relationship with modernity. The ways in which its policies in different areas resembled or differed from those pursued elsewhere in Europe and beyond during the 1930s, and much more besides. A narrative thread is provided by the arrangement of the chapters, which move progressively closer to the war as the audiobook moves along. Inevitably, however, while separating out the many different aspects of the Third Reich into different themes makes it easier to present them coherently, it also comes at a price. Since these aspects impinge on each other in a variety of different ways, foreign policy had an impact on racial policy. Racial policy had an impact on educational policy. Propaganda went hand in hand with repression, and so on. So the treatment of a theme in a particular chapter is necessarily incomplete in itself. And the individual chapters should not be treated as comprehensive accounts of the topics with which they deal. Thus, for example, the removal of the Jews from the economy is dealt with in the chapter on the economy, rather than in the chapter on racial policy. Hitler's formulation of his war aims in the so-called Hossbach Memorandum in 1937 is covered in the section on rearmament, rather than in the chapter on foreign policy. And the impact of the German takeover of Austria on anti-Semitism in the Third Reich is discussed in the final chapter, rather than in the section on anti-Semitism in 1938. I hope that these decisions about the structure of the book make sense, but their logic will only be clear to those who listen to the audiobook consecutively from start to finish. Anyone who wants to use it simply as a work of reference is recommended to turn to the index, where the location of the book's principal themes, characters, and events is laid out in detail. Richard J. Evans, Cambridge, May 2005. Prologue. 1. The Third Reich came to power in the first half of 1933 on the ruins of Germany's first attempt at democracy, the ill-fated Weimar Republic. By July, the Nazis had created virtually all the fundamental features of the regime that was to govern Germany until its collapse almost 12 years later in 1945. They had eliminated open opposition at every level, created a one-party state, and coordinated all the major institutions of German society, with the exceptions of the army and the churches. Many people have tried to explain how they managed to achieve such a position of total dominance in German politics and society with such speed. One tradition of explanation points to long-term weaknesses in the German national character that made it hostile to democracy, inclined to follow ruthless leaders, and susceptible to the appeal of militarists and demagogues. But when one looks at the 19th century, one can see very little evidence of such traits. Liberal and democratic movements were no weaker than they were in many other countries. More relevant, perhaps, was the relatively late creation of a German nation-state. After the collapse in 1806 of the Holy Roman Reich, created by Charlemagne a millennium before, the famous Thousand-Year Reich that Hitler sought to emulate, Germany was disunited until the wars engineered by Bismarck between 1864 and 1871, which led to the formation of what was later called the Second Reich, the German Empire ruled by the Kaiser. In many ways, this was a modern state. It had a national parliament that, unlike its British counterpart, for example, was elected by universal manhood suffrage. Elections attracted a voter turnout of over 80%, and political parties were well organized and an accepted part of the political system. The largest of these, by 1914, the Social Democratic Party, had over 1 million members and was committed to democracy, equality, the emancipation of women, and the ending of racial discrimination and prejudice, including anti-Semitism. Germany's economy was the most dynamic in the world, rapidly overtaking the British by the turn of the century, and in the most advanced areas like the electrical and chemical industries, rivaling even the Americans. Middle-class values, culture, and behavior were dominant in Germany by the turn of the century. Modern art and culture were beginning to make their mark in the paintings of expressionists like Max Beckmann and Ernst Ludwig Kirchner, the plays of Frank Wedekind, and the novels of Thomas Mann. Of course, there was a downside to the Bismarckian Reich. Aristocratic privilege remained entrenched in some areas. The national parliament's powers were limited, and the big industrialists, like their counterparts in the USA, were deeply hostile to unionized labor. Bismarck's persecution, first of the Catholics in the 1870s, then of the fledgling Social Democratic Party in the 1880s, got Germans used to the idea that a government could declare whole categories of the population enemies of the Reich and drastically curtail their civil liberties. The Catholics responded by trying to integrate more closely into the social and political system, the Social Democrats by sticking rigidly to the law and repudiating the idea of violent resistance or violent revolution. Both behavioral traits that were to resurface to disastrous effect in 1933. In the 1890s, too, small extremist political parties and movements emerged, arguing that Bismarck's work of unification was incomplete because millions of ethnic Germans still lived outside the Reich, especially in Austria, but also in many other parts of Eastern Europe. While some politicians began to argue that Germany needed a large overseas empire like the British already possessed, others began to tap lower-middle-class feelings of being overtaken by big business. The small shopkeeper's fear of the department store. The male clerk's resentment of the growing presence in business of the female secretary. The bourgeois sense of disorientation when confronted by expressionist and abstract art, and many other unsettling effects of Germany's headlong social, economic, and cultural modernization. Such groups found an easy target in Germany's tiny minority of Jews, a mere 1% of the population, who had mostly been remarkably successful in German society and culture since their emancipation from legal restrictions in the course of the 19th century. For the anti-Semites, the Jews were a source of all their problems. They argued that the civil liberties of the Jews had to be restricted and their economic activities curtailed. Soon, political parties like the Center Party and the Conservatives were losing votes to these fringe parties of anti-Semites. They responded by incorporating into their own programs the promise to reduce what they described as the subversive influence of the Jews in German society and culture. At the same time, in a very different area of society, social Darwinists and eugenicists were beginning to argue that the German race needed to be strengthened by discarding the traditional Christian respect for life and by sterilizing or even killing the weak, the handicapped, the criminal, and the insane. These were still minority strands of thought before 1914, nor did anyone weld them together into any kind of effective synthesis. Anti-Semitism was widespread in German society, but overt violence against Jews was still rare. What changed this situation was the First World War. In August 1914, cheering crowds greeted the outbreak of war on Germany's main town squares, as they did in other countries too. The Kaiser declared that he recognized no parties anymore, only Germans. The spirit of 1914 became a mythical symbol of national unity, just as the image of Bismarck conjured up a mythical nostalgia for a strong and decisive political leader. The military stalemate reached by 1916 led to the German war effort being put in the hands of two generals who had won major victories on the Eastern Front, Paul von Hindenburg and Erich Ludendorff. But despite their tight organization of the war effort, Germany was unable to withstand the might of the Americans when they entered the war in 1917, and by early November 1918, the war was lost. Defeat in the First World War had a disastrous effect on Germany. The peace terms, though no harsher than those which Germany planned to impose on other countries in the event of victory, were bitterly resented by almost all Germans. They included the demand for massive financial reparations for the damage caused by the German occupation of Belgium and northern France, the destruction of the German Navy and Air Force, the restriction of the German army to 100,000 men, and the banning of modern weapons, like tanks, the loss of territory to France and above all to Poland. The war also destroyed the international economy, which did not recover for another 30 years. Not only were there huge costs to pay, but the collapse of the Habsburg Empire and the creation of new independent states in Eastern Europe fueled national economic egotism and made international economic cooperation impossible. Germany, in particular, had paid for the war by printing money in the hope of backing it by annexing industrial areas of France and Belgium. The German economy could not meet the reparations bill without raising taxes, and no German government was willing to do this, because it would have meant its opponents would have been able to accuse it of taxing the Germans to pay the French. Inflation was the result. In 1913, the dollar had been worth 4 paper marks. By the end of 1919, it was worth 47. By July 1922, 493. By December 1922, 7,000. Reparations had to be paid in gold and in goods, and at this rate of inflation, the Germans were neither willing nor able to manage it. In January 1923, the French and Belgians occupied the Ruhr and began to seize industrial assets and products. The German government announced a policy of non-cooperation. This sparked a decline of the mark's value against the dollar that was unprecedented in scale. An American dollar cost 353,000 marks in July 1923. In August, 4.5 million. In October, 25,260 million. In December, 4 million million, or 4 followed by 12 knots. Economic collapse stared Germany in the face. Eventually, the inflation was halted. A new currency was introduced. Passive resistance to the Franco-Belgian occupation ended. The foreign troops withdrew. Reparations payments resumed. The inflation fragmented the middle classes by pitting one interest group against another, so that no political party was able to unite them. The post-inflation stabilization, retrenchment, and rationalization meant massive job losses, both in industry and in the civil service. From 1924 onwards, there were millions of unemployed. Business resented the failure of government to help it in this deflationary situation and began to look for alternatives. For the middle classes in general, the inflation meant a moral and cultural disorientation that was only worsened for many by what they saw as the excesses of modern culture in the 1920s, from jazz and cabaret in Berlin to abstract art, atonal music, and experimental literature such as the concrete poetry of the Dadaists. This sense of disorientation was present in politics, too, as defeat in war had brought about the collapse of the Reich, the flight of the Kaiser into exile, and the creation of the Weimar Republic in the Revolution of November 1918. The Weimar Republic had a modern constitution with female suffrage and proportional representation, but these were not instrumental in its downfall. The real problem of the constitution was the independently elected president, who had wide-ranging emergency powers under Article 48 of the Constitution to rule by decree. This was already used extensively by the Republic's first president, the Social Democrat Friedrich Ebert. When he died in 1925, his elected successor was Field Marshal Paul von Hindenburg, a staunch monarchist who had no deep commitment to the Constitution. In his hands, Article 48 would prove fatal to the Republic's survival. The final legacy of the First World War was a cult of violence, not just in the hands of veterans such as the radical right-wing steel helmets, but more particularly in the younger generation of men who had not been old enough to fight and now tried to match the heroic deeds of their elders by fighting on the home front. The war polarized politics, with communist revolutionaries on the left and various radical groups emerging on the right. The most notorious of these were the Free Corps, armed bands who were used by the government to put down communist and far-left revolutionary uprisings in Berlin and Munich in the winter of 1918-1919. The Free Corps attempted a violent coup d'etat in Berlin in the early spring of 1920, which led to an armed left-wing uprising in the Ruhr, while there were further left and right-wing uprisings in 1923. Even in the relatively stable years from 1924 to 1929, at least 170 members of various political paramilitary squads were killed in street fighting. In the early 1930s, the deaths and injuries escalated dramatically, with 300 killed in street and meeting room clashes in the year from March 1930 to March 1931 alone. Political tolerance had given way to violent extremism. The parties of the liberal center and moderate left suffered dramatic electoral losses in the mid-1920s as the specter of communist revolution retreated and the middle classes voted for parties further to the right. Those parties that actively supported the Weimar Republic never had a parliamentary majority after 1920. Finally, the Republic's legitimacy was further undermined by the bias of the judiciary in favor of right-wing assassins and insurgents who claimed patriotism as their motive, and by the neutral stance taken by the army, which became steadily more resentful at the Republic's failure to persuade the international community to lift the restrictions placed on its numbers and equipment by the Treaty of Versailles. German democracy, hastily improvised in the aftermath of military defeat, was by no means doomed to failure from the start. But the events of the 1920s meant that it never had much of a chance to establish itself on a stable footing. 2. There was a huge variety of extremist, anti-Semitic groups on the far right in 1919, especially in Munich. But by 1923, one of them stood out above the rest, the National Socialist German Workers' Party, led by Adolf Hitler. So much has been written about the power and impact of Hitler and the Nazis that it is important to point out that his party was out on the far margins of politics until the very end of the 1920s. Hitler, in other words, was not a political genius who raised mass support for himself and his party single-handedly. Born in Austria in 1889, he was a failed artist with a bohemian lifestyle who possessed one great gift: the ability to move crowds with his rhetoric. His party, founded in 1919, was more dynamic, more ruthless, and more violent than other extreme right-wing fringe groups. In 1923, it felt confident enough to try a violent coup d'etat in Munich as a prelude to a march on Berlin along the lines of Mussolini's successful march on Rome the previous year. But it failed to win over the army or the forces of political conservatism in Bavaria, and the coup was dissipated in a hail of gunfire. Hitler was convicted and put into Landsberg prison, where he dedicated his autobiographical political tract, My Struggle, to his dog's body, Rudolf Hess. Not a blueprint for the future, to be sure, but a compendium of Hitler's ideas, above all anti-Semitism, and the idea of a racial conquest of Eastern Europe, for all who cared to read it. By the time he came out of prison, Hitler had assembled the ideology of Nazism from disparate elements of anti-Semitism, pan-Germanism, eugenics and so-called racial hygiene, geopolitical expansionism, hostility to democracy, and hostility to cultural modernism, which had been floating around for some time but had not so far been integrated into a coherent whole. He gathered around him a team of immediate subordinates, the talented propagandist Joseph Goebbels, the decisive man of action Hermann Göring, and others, who built up his image as leader and reinforced his sense of destiny. But despite all this, and despite the violent activism of his brown shirt paramilitaries on the streets, he got nowhere politically until the very end of the 1920s. In May 1928, the Nazis only won 2.6% of the vote. And a grand coalition of centrist and leftist parties, led by the Social Democrats, took office in Berlin. In October 1929, however, the Wall Street crash brought the German economy tumbling down with it. American banks withdrew the loans on which the German economic recovery had been financed since 1924. German banks had to call in their loans to German businesses in response, and businesses had no option but to lay off workers or go bankrupt, which indeed many of them did. Within little more than 2 years, more than one German worker in three was unemployed, and millions more were on short-term work or reduced wages. The unemployment insurance system broke down completely, leaving increasing numbers destitute. Agriculture, already under strain because of a fall in world demand, collapsed as well. The political effects of the Depression were calamitous. The Grand Coalition broke up in disarray. So deep were the divisions between the parties over how to deal with the crisis that a parliamentary majority could no longer be found for any kind of decisive action. Reich President Hindenburg appointed a cabinet of experts under the Catholic politician Heinrich Brüning, an avowed monarchist. It proceeded to impose savagely deflationary cutbacks, only making the situation worse still. And it did so by using the presidential power of rule by decree under Article 48 of the Constitution, bypassing the Reichstag altogether. Political power was diverted from Parliament upwards to the circle around Hindenburg, who could use his power of ruling by decree, and downwards onto the streets, where violence escalated exponentially, pushed on by Hitler's brown-shirted stormtroopers, now numbering hundreds of thousands. For the thousands of young men who joined the brown shirts, violence quickly became a way of life, almost a drug, as they launched against the communists and the social democrats, the fury their elders had vented on the enemy in 1914 to 1918. Many brown shirts were without a job in the early 1930s. It was not unemployment, however, that drove people to support the Nazis. The unemployed flocked above all to the communists, whose vote rose steadily until it reached 17%, giving the party 100 seats in the Reichstag in November 1932. The communists' violent revolutionary rhetoric, promising the destruction of capitalism and the creation of a Soviet Germany, terrified the country's middle classes, who knew only too well what had happened to their counterparts in Russia after 1918. Appalled at the failure of the government to solve the crisis, and frightened into desperation by the rise of the communists, they began to leave the squabbling little factions of the conventional political right and gravitate towards the Nazis instead. Other groups followed, including many Protestant small farmers and manual workers from areas where the culture and traditions of the Social Democrats were weak. While all the middle-class parties collapsed completely, the Social Democrats and the Center Party managed to restrict their losses. But by 1932, they were all that was left of the moderate center, squashed helplessly between 100 uniformed communist and 196 brown-shirted deputies in the Reichstag. The polarization of politics could hardly be more dramatic. The Nazis, then, as the elections of September 1930 and July 1932 showed, were a catch-all party of social protest with particularly strong middle-class support and relatively weak, though still very significant, working-class backing at the polls. They had broken out of their core constituency of the Protestant lower-middle classes and farming community. Other parties, appalled at their losses, tried to beat them at their own game. This had nothing to do with specific policies, much more with the image of dynamism that the Nazis projected. The hated, calamitous Weimar Republic had to be got rid of, and the people united once more in a national community that knew no parties or classes, just as it had been in 1914. Germany had to reassert itself on the international scene and become a leading power again. That was more or less what the Nazis' program amounted to. They modified their specific policies according to their audience, playing down their anti-Semitism, where it met with no response, for example, which is to say, in most parts of the electorate after 1928. Besides the Nazis and the communists battling it out on the streets, and the intriguers around President Hindenburg vying for the old man's ear, a third major player now entered the political game, the army. Increasingly alarmed by the rise of communism and the growing mayhem on the streets, the army also saw the new political situation as an opportunity to get rid of Weimar democracy and impose an authoritarian, military dictatorship that would repudiate the Treaty of Versailles and rearm the country in preparation for a war of reconquest of Germany's lost territories, and perhaps more besides. The army's power lay in the fact that it was the only force that could effectively restore order in the shattered country. When President Hindenburg's re-election in 1932 was achieved only with the help of the Social Democrats, who backed him as a less unacceptable choice than his main rival, Hitler, Chancellor Brüning's days were numbered. He had failed in almost everything he had undertaken, from solving the economic crisis to restoring order to Germany's towns and cities, and he had now offended Hindenburg by failing to secure his re-election unopposed, and by proposing the breakup of the kind of landed estate Hindenburg himself owned in eastern Germany to help the destitute peasantry. The army was anxious to get rid of Brüning because his deflationary policies were preventing rearmament. Like many conservative groups, it hoped to enlist the Nazis, now the largest political party, as legitimation and support for the destruction of Weimar democracy. In May 1932, Brüning was forced to resign and replaced by the Catholic landed aristocrat Franz von Papen, a personal friend of Hindenburg's. Papen's advent to power sounded the death knell of Weimar democracy. He used the army to depose the Social Democratic state government in Prussia and prepared to reform the Weimar Constitution by restricting voting rights and drastically curtailing the legislative powers of the Reichstag. He began to ban critical issues of daily newspapers and to restrict civil freedoms. But the elections he called in July 1932 only registered a further increase in the Nazi vote, which now reached 37.4% of the poll. Papen's attempt to enlist Hitler and the Nazis in support of his government failed when Hitler insisted that he, and not Papen, had to head the government. Lacking almost any support in the country, Papen was forced to resign when the army lost patience with him and put its own man into office. The new head of government, General Kurt von Schleicher, did no better at restoring order or co-opting the Nazis to give the semblance of popular backing to his policy of creating an authoritarian state. After the Nazis had lost 2 million votes in the Reichstag elections of November 1932, their evident decline and their obvious lack of funds created a serious division in the party's ranks. The party's organizer and effective second man after Hitler, Gregor Strasser, resigned from the party in frustration at Hitler's refusal to negotiate with Hindenburg and Papen. The moment seemed right to take advantage of the Nazis' weakness. On January 30, 1933, with the agreement of the army, Hindenburg appointed Hitler as head of a new government in which all the other posts, bar two, were held by conservatives, with Papen as deputy chancellor at their head. 3. In reality, January 30, 1933, marked the beginning of the Nazi seizure of power, not of a conservative counter-revolution. Hitler had avoided the mistakes he had made 10 years previously. He had achieved office without formally destroying the Constitution, and with the support of the conservative establishment and the army. The question now was how to convert his position in yet another Weimar coalition cabinet into a dictatorship in a one-party state. First, all he could think of doing was to intensify the violence on the streets. He persuaded Papen to appoint Hermann Göring as Prussian Minister of the Interior, and in this capacity, Göring promptly enrolled the brown shirts as auxiliary police. They went on the rampage, smashing trade union offices, beating up communists, and breaking up social democratic meetings. On February 28th, chance came to the Nazis' aid. A lone Dutch anarcho-syndicalist, Marinus von der Lubbe, burned down the Reichstag building in protest against the injustices of unemployment. Hitler and Göring persuaded a willing cabinet effectively to suppress the Communist Party. 4,000 communists, including virtually the entire party leadership, were immediately arrested, beaten up, tortured, and thrown into newly created concentration camps. There was no let-up in the campaign of violence and brutality in the weeks that followed. By the end of March, the Prussian police reported that 20,000 communists were in prison. By the summer, over 100,000 communists, social democrats, trade unionists, and others had been arrested, with even official estimates putting the number of deaths in custody at 600. All of this was sanctioned by an emergency decree signed by Hindenburg the night after the fire, suspending civil liberties and allowing the cabinet to take any necessary measures to protect public safety. Von der Lubbers Lone Act was portrayed by Josef Goebbels, soon to become Reich propaganda minister, as the result of a communist conspiracy to stage an armed uprising. This convinced many middle-class voters that the decree was right. Yet the government did not ban the communists in a formal legal sense because it feared that the party's voters would all desert to the Social Democrats in the elections Hitler had called for March 5th. Amidst massive Nazi propaganda, paid for by an inflow of fresh funds from industry, and violent intimidation, in which most rival political meetings were banned or broken up, the Nazis still failed to achieve an overall majority, peaking at 44%, and only getting over the 50% barrier with the help of their conservative nationalist coalition partners. The communists still won 12%, and the Social Democrats 18%, with the Center Party holding firm at 11% of the vote. This meant that Hitler and his cabinet colleagues were still far short of the two-thirds majority they needed to alter the Constitution. But on March 23, 1933, they still managed to get it by threatening civil war if they were frustrated, and by winning over the Center Party deputies with a promise of a comprehensive concordat with the papacy, guaranteeing Catholics' rights. The so-called Enabling Act passed by the Reichstag that day gave the cabinet the right to rule by decree without reference either to the Reichstag or to the president. Together with the Reichstag fire decree, it provided the legal pretext for the creation of a dictatorship. Only the 94 Social Democratic deputies present voted against it. The Social Democrats and communists between them had won 221 seats in the Reichstag elections of November 1932, as against 196 for the Nazis and another 51 for the Nazis' allies, the Nationalists. But they failed completely to mount a concerted resistance to the Nazi seizure of power. They were bitterly divided. The communists, under orders from Stalin in Moscow, labeled the Social Democrats social fascists and argued that they were worse than the Nazis. The Social Democrats were reluctant to cooperate with a party whose deviousness and unscrupulousness they rightly feared. Their paramilitary organizations fought hard against the Nazis on the streets, but they would have been no match for the army, which backed the Hitler government all the way in 1933, and their numbers were also well below those of the stormtroopers, who numbered more than 750,000 in February 1933. The Social Democrats wanted to avoid bloodshed in this situation and stayed true to their law-abiding traditions. The communists believed that the Hitler government was the last gasp of a morbid capitalist system that would quickly collapse, opening the way to a proletarian revolution, so they saw no need to prepare for an uprising. Finally, a general strike was out of the question when unemployment stood at 35%. Striking workers would quickly have been replaced by unemployed people desperate to rescue themselves and their families from destitution. Goebbels got the agreement of the trade union leaders to support the creation of a new national holiday on May Day, a long-held demand of the unions, and turned it into a so-called Day of National Labor, with hundreds of thousands of workers gathering on Germany's public squares under the swastika to listen to speeches by Hitler and the other Nazi leaders broadcast over loudspeakers. The next day, stormtroopers all over Germany raided trade union and social democratic offices and premises, looted them, carried off the funds, and closed them down. Within a few weeks, mass arrests of union officials and social democratic leaders, many of whom were beaten up and tortured in makeshift concentration camps, had broken the spirit of the labor movement. Other parties were now targeted in turn. The liberal and splinter parties, reduced by electoral attrition to being small groups on the fringes of politics, were forced to dissolve themselves. A whispering campaign began against Hitler's nationalist coalition partners, coupled with the harassment and arrest of nationalist officials and deputies. Hitler's chief nationalist ally, Alfred Hugenberg, was forced to resign from the cabinet, while the party's floor leader in the Reichstag was found dead in his office in suspicious circumstances. Protests by Hugenberg met with an hysterical outburst from Hitler, in which he threatened a bloodbath if the nationalists resisted any longer. By the end of June, the nationalists, too, had been dissolved. The remaining big independent party, the Center, suffered a similar fate. Nazi threats to sack Catholic civil servants and close down Catholic lay organizations, combined with the papacy's panic fear of communism, led to a deal concluded in Rome. The party agreed to dissolve itself in return for the finalization of the concordant already promised at the time of the Enabling Act. This supposedly guaranteed the integrity of the Catholic Church in Germany, along with all its assets and organizations. Time would show that this was not worth the paper it was written on. In the meantime, however, the Center Party followed the others into oblivion. By the middle of July 1933, Germany was a one-party state, a position ratified by a law formally banning all other parties apart from the Nazis. It was not just parties and trade unions that were abolished, however. The Nazi assault on existing institutions affected the whole of society. Every state government, every state parliament in Germany's federal political system, every town and district and local council was ruthlessly purged. The Reichstag fire decree and the Enabling Act were used to dismiss supposed enemies of the state, meaning enemies of the Nazis. Every national voluntary association and every local club was brought under Nazi control, from industrial and agricultural pressure groups to sports associations, football clubs, male vocal choirs, women's organizations. In short, the whole fabric of associational life was Nazified. Rival, politically oriented clubs or societies were merged into a single Nazi body. Existing leaders of voluntary associations were either unceremoniously ousted or knuckled under of their own accord. Many organizations expelled politically leftish or liberal members and declared their allegiance to the new state and its institutions. This whole process, coordination in Nazi jargon, went on all over Germany from March to June 1933. By the end, virtually the only non-Nazi associations left were the army and the churches with their lay organizations. While this was going on, the government passed a law that allowed it to purge the civil service, a vast organization in Germany that included school teachers, university staff, judges, and many other professions that were not government-controlled in other countries. Social Democrats, liberals, and not a few Catholics and conservatives were ousted here too. To save their jobs at a time when unemployment had reached terrifying dimensions, 1.6 million people joined the Nazi Party between January 30th and May 1st, 1933, when the party leadership banned any more recruiting, while the number of brown shirt paramilitaries grew to over 2 million by the summer of 1933. The proportion of civil servants, judges, and the like who were actually sacked for political reasons was very small. The major reason for dismissal, however, was not political, but racial. The civil service law passed by the Nazis on April 7, 1933, allowed dismissal of Jewish civil servants, though Hindenburg had succeeded in getting a clause inserted protecting the jobs of Jewish war veterans and those appointed under the Kaiser before 1914. The Jews, Hitler claimed, were a subversive, parasitical element who had to be got rid of. In fact, most Jews were middle class, and liberal to conservative in their politics, insofar as they had any. Nevertheless, Hitler believed that they had deliberately undermined Germany during the First World War and caused the revolution that created the Weimar Republic. A few socialist and communist leaders had been Jewish, it is true, but the majority were not. For the Nazis, this made no difference. The day after the March election, stormtroopers rampaged along the Kurfürstendamm, a fashionable shopping street in Berlin, hunting down Jews and beating them up. Synagogues were trashed, while all over Germany, gangs of brown shirts burst into courthouses and dragged off Jewish judges and lawyers, beating them with rubber truncheons and telling them not to return. Jews who were amongst those arrested as communists or social democrats were particularly harshly treated. Over 40 Jews had been murdered by stormtroopers by the end of June 1933. Such incidents were widely reported in the foreign press. This formed the pretext for Hitler, Goebbels, and the Nazi leadership to put into action a long, mulled-over plan to stage a nationwide boycott of Jewish shops and businesses. On April 1, 1933, stormtroopers stood menacingly outside such premises, warning people not to enter them. Most non-Jewish Germans obeyed, but not with any enthusiasm. The biggest Jewish firms were untouched because they contributed too much to the economy. Realizing it had failed to arouse popular enthusiasm, Goebbels called the action off after a few days. But the beatings, the violence, and the boycott had their effect on the Jewish community in Germany, 37,000 of whose members had emigrated by the end of the year. The regime's purge of Jews, whom it defined not by their religious adherence but by racial criteria, had a particular effect in science, culture, and the arts. Jewish conductors and musicians, such as Bruno Walter and Otto Klemperer, were summarily dismissed or prevented from performing. The film industry and radio were rapidly purged of both Jews and political opponents of the Nazis. Non-Nazi newspapers were closed down or brought under Nazi control, while the Journalists' Union and the Newspaper Publishers Association both placed themselves under Nazi leadership. Left-wing and liberal writers, such as Bertolt Brecht, Thomas Mann, and many others, were stopped from publishing. Many left the country. Hitler reserved his particular enmity for modern artists like Paul Klee, Max Beckmann, Ernst Ludwig Kirchner, and Vasily Kandinsky. Before 1914, he had been rejected from the Vienna Art Academy because his painstakingly representational drawings of buildings had been thought talentless. Under the Weimar Republic, abstract and expressionist artists had gained wealth and reputation with what Hitler thought were ugly and meaningless daubs. While Hitler railed against modern art in his speeches, gallery and museum directors were sacked and replaced with men who enthusiastically removed modernist works from exhibition. The many modernist artists and composers, like Klee or Schoenberg, who held positions in state educational institutions, were all fired. Together, about 2,000 people active in the arts emigrated from Germany in 1933 and the following years. They included virtually everyone with an international reputation. Nazi anti-intellectualism was underlined still further by events in the universities. Here, too, Jewish professors in all fields were dismissed. Many, including Albert Einstein, Gustav Hertz, Erwin Schrödinger, Max Born, and 20 past or future Nobel Prize winners left the country. By 1934, some 1,600 out of 5,000 university teachers had been forced out of their jobs, a third because they were Jewish, the rest because they were political opponents of the Nazis. 16% of physics professors and assistants emigrated. In the universities, it was above all the students, helped by a small number of Nazi professors, such as the philosopher Martin Heidegger, who drove the purges on. They forced Jewish and leftist protesters out by violent demonstrations, and then, On May 10, 1933, they organized demonstrations in the main squares of 19 university towns and cities, in which huge numbers of books by Jewish and left-wing authors were piled up and set alight. What the Nazis were trying to achieve was a cultural revolution in which alien cultural influences, notably the Jews, but also modernist culture more generally, were eliminated and the German spirit reborn. Germans did not just have to acquiesce in the Third Reich. They had to support it with all their heart and soul. And the creation of the propaganda ministry under Joseph Goebbels, which soon acquired control over the whole sphere of culture and the arts, was the main means by which the Nazis sought to achieve this end. Nevertheless, Nazism was, in many respects, a thoroughly modern phenomenon, keen to use the latest technology, the newest weapons, and the most scientific means of reshaping German society to its will. Race, for the Nazis, was a scientific concept, and by making it the basis of all their policies, they were taking their stand on what they conceived of as the application of scientific method to human society. Nothing, neither religious beliefs, nor ethical scruples, nor long-hallowed tradition, was to get in the way of this revolution. Yet in the summer of 1933, Hitler felt constrained to tell his followers that it was time for the revolution to come to a stop. Germany needed a period of stability. This audiobook begins at that moment, the moment when the destruction of the remnants of the Weimar Republic had been completed and the Third Reich was finally in power. Part 1. The Police State. Night of the Long Knives. 1. On July 6, 1933, Hitler gathered leading Nazis together for a stocktaking of the general situation. The National Socialists' revolution had succeeded, he told them. Power was theirs, and theirs alone. It was now, he said, time to stabilize the regime. There should be no more talk of the kind that had been circulating amongst senior members of the brown-shirted paramilitary wing of the party, the Storm Division, or SA, of a second revolution to follow the conquest of power. Hitler said, "Revolution is not a permanent condition. It must not develop into a permanent condition. The stream of revolution has been undammed, but it must be channeled into the secure bed of evolution." The slogan of the Second Revolution was justified as long as positions were still present in Germany that could serve as points of crystallization for a counter-revolution. That is not the case any longer. We do not leave any doubt about the fact that, if necessary, we will drown such an attempt in blood. For a second revolution can only direct itself against the first one. This declaration was followed by numerous similar, if less overtly threatening, statements by other Nazi leaders in the following weeks. Pressure was mounting from the Reich Justice and Interior Ministries to deal with arbitrary violence, and the Reich Economics Ministry was worried that continuing unrest would give the international financial community the impression of continuing instability in Germany, and so discourage economic investment and recovery. The Interior Ministry complained about arrests of civil servants. The Justice Ministry about arrests of lawyers. Brownshirt violence was continuing all over the country, most notoriously in the Kupinik Blood Week in June 1933, when a raiding party of stormtroopers had encountered resistance from a young social democrat in a Berlin suburb. After the social democrat shot three stormtroopers dead, the brownshirts mobilized en masse and arrested more than 500 local men, torturing them so brutally that 91 of them died. Amongst them were many well-known social democratic politicians, including the former minister-president of Mecklenburg, Johannes Stelling. Clearly, this kind of violence had to be checked. It was no longer necessary to beat the opponents of the Nazis into submission and establish a one-party state. Moreover, Hitler was beginning to be concerned about the power that the rampages of the ever-expanding SA gave to its leader, Ernst Röhm, who had declared on May 30, 1933, that its task of completing the National Socialist Revolution still lies before it. Whether declarations of loyalty come every day from coordinated beekeeping or bowling clubs makes no odds, Röhm added, nor whether a town's streets get up-to-date names. Others might celebrate the Nazi victory, but the political soldiers who had fought it, he said, had to take matters in hand and carry it further. On August 2, 1933, worried by such declarations, Hermann Göring, acting in his capacity as Minister President of Prussia, rescinded an order of the previous February enrolling the brown shirts as auxiliary officers of the Prussian police. The ministries of other federated states followed suit. The established police force now had more room for maneuver in dealing with the stormtroopers' excesses. The Prussian Ministry of Justice set up a central public prosecutor's office to deal with murders and other serious crimes in the concentration camps, though it also ordered the end of ongoing prosecutions of SA and SS men for crimes of violence, and the pardoning of those few who had actually been sentenced. Strict regulations were issued about who was entitled to place people in protective custody, and what procedures were to be observed in doing so. An indication of what had been the practice to date was provided by the prohibitions contained in the Consolidated Regulations issued in April 1934. No one was to be taken into protective custody for personal reasons such as slander, or because they had dismissed employees, or acted as legal representatives of people subsequently imprisoned, or had brought an objectionable legal action before the courts. Deprived of its initial raison d'etre as the street-fighting, saloon-brawling arm of the Nazi movement, and removed from its position in charge of many small, improvised prison camps and torture centers, the SA found itself suddenly without a role. Elections were no longer seriously contested, so the stormtroopers were robbed of the opportunity that the constant electioneering of the early 1930s had given them to parade through the streets and break up the meetings of their opponents. Disillusion began to set in. The SA had expanded hugely in the spring of 1933, as sympathizers and opportunists from many quarters flooded in. In March 1933, Röhm had announced that any patriotically minded German man could join. When recruitment to the Nazi Party had been halted in May 1933, because the party leadership feared that too many opportunists were joining and their movement was being swamped by men who were not really committed to their cause, many people had seen enrollment in the brown shirts as an alternative, thus weakening the links between the party and its paramilitary wing. The incorporation of the huge Veterans Association, the Steel Helmets, into the brown shirt organization in the second half of 1933 further boosted SA numbers. At the beginning of 1934, there were six times as many stormtroopers as there had been at the beginning of the previous year. The total strength of the storm division now stood at nearly 3 million men. 4.5 million if the Steel Helmets and other incorporated paramilitary groups were counted in. This completely dwarfed the size of the German armed forces, which were legally restricted to a mere 100,000 by the Treaty of Versailles. At the same time, however, despite restrictions imposed by the treaty, the army was by far the better equipped and better trained fighting force. The specter of civil war that had loomed so ominously at the beginning of 1933 was beginning to raise its head once more. The discontents of the stormtroopers were not confined to envy of the army and impatience with the stabilization of politics after July 1933. Many old fighters resented the newcomers who jumped onto the Nazi bandwagon early in 1933. Tension was particularly high with the former Steel Helmets who came into the organization. It increasingly found an outlet in fights and scuffles in the early months of 1934. In Pomerania, the police banned former Steel Helmet units, now organized as the National Socialist German Front Fighters League, after a stormtrooper leader was murdered by an ex-Steel Helmet member. But the resentment of old brown shirts could also be felt on a wider scale. Many had expected rich rewards on the elimination of the Nazis' rivals, and were disappointed when established local politicians and conservative partners of the Nazis took many of the best pickings. One brown shirt activist, born in 1897, wrote in 1934, "After the seizure of power, things changed dramatically. People who had hitherto scorned me were now overflowing with praises. In my family and among all the relatives, I was now considered number one, after years of bitter feuding. My storm division grew by leaps and bounds from month to month, so that from 250 in January, by October 1, 1933, I had 2,200 members, which led to my promotion to senior storm division leader at Christmas time. The more the Philistines lauded me, however, the more I came to suspect that these scoundrels thought they had me in the bag. After the incorporation of the Steel Helmets, when things came to a stop, I turned on the reactionary clique which was sneakily trying to make me look ridiculous before my superiors. There were all kinds of denunciations against me at the higher SA offices and with the public authorities. Finally, I succeeded in being appointed local mayor, so that I could break the necks of all the prominent Philistines and the reactionary leftovers of the old times." Such feelings were even stronger amongst the many veteran stormtroopers who failed to maneuver themselves into positions of power as successfully as this man did. As the young brown shirts found their violent energies deprived of an overtly political outlet, they became involved in increasing numbers of brawls and fights all over Germany, often without any obvious political motive. Gangs of stormtroopers got drunk, caused disturbances late at night, beat up innocent passers-by, and attacked the police if they tried to stop them. Matters were made still worse by Rome's attempt to remove the brown shirts from the jurisdiction of the police and the courts in December 1933. Henceforth, the stormtroopers were told that all disciplinary matters had to be handled by the organization itself. This was a license for inaction, even though prosecution still took place. Rome found more difficulty in establishing a separate SA jurisdiction that would deal retroactively with more than 4,000 prosecutions of SA and SS men for crimes of various kinds that were still before the courts in May 1934, mostly resulting from the early months of 1933. Many others had been quashed, and more offenses still had never been prosecuted in the first place, but this was still a considerable number. Moreover, the army had its own courts-martial. By so setting up a parallel system within the SA, Rome would obtain a large measure of equal status to it for his own organization. Privately, he had announced the previous July that an SA leader with jurisdiction over the murder of an SA man would be able to sentence to death up to 12 members of the enemy organization which initiated the murder. This gave a grim indication of the nature of the justice system he hoped to create. Clearly, some means had to be found of diverting all this excess energy into useful channels. But leadership of the SA only made matters worse by seeking to direct the movement's violent activism into what a regional leader in the East, Edmund Heinz, publicly described as the continuation of the German Revolution. As head of the SA, Ernst Röhm spoke at numerous rallies and marches in the first months of 1934, emphasizing in similar fashion the revolutionary nature of Nazism and launching open attacks on the party leadership, and in particular the German army, whose senior officers the brown shirts blame for their temporary banning by order of former Reich Chancellor Heinrich Brüning in 1932. Röhm caused considerable alarm in the army hierarchy when he declared that he wanted the stormtroopers to form the basis of a national militia, effectively bypassing and perhaps eventually replacing the army altogether. Hitler attempted to fob him off by making him minister without portfolio with a seat in the cabinet in December 1933. But given the increasing redundancy of the cabinet by this stage, this meant very little in practical terms, and was no substitute for Rome's real ambition, which was to occupy the Ministry of Defense, held at the time by the army's representative, General Werner von Blumberg. Deprived of real power at the center, Rome began to build up a cult of his own leadership within the SA, and continued to preach the need for further revolution. In January 1934, stormtroopers gave practical expression to their radicalism when they burst into the Hotel Kaiserhof in Berlin and broke up a celebration of the ex-Kaiser's birthday being held there by a number of army officers. The next day, Rome sent Blumberg a memorandum. Perhaps exaggerating its import for effect, Blumberg said that it demanded that the SA should replace the army as the country's main fighting force, and the traditional military should be restricted to training the stormtroopers to assume this role. To the army leadership, the brown shirts now appeared an increasingly serious threat. Since the summer of 1933, Blumberg had brought the army round from its previous formal political neutrality towards increasingly open support for the regime. Blumberg and his allies were seduced by Hitler's promises of a massive expansion of German military strength through the resumption of conscription. They had been won over by Hitler's assurance that he would conduct an aggressive foreign policy that would culminate in the recovery of the territories lost by the Treaty of Versailles and the launching of a new war of conquest in the East. Blumberg, in turn, ostentatiously, demonstrated his loyalty to the Third Reich by adopting the Aryan paragraph, which banned Jews from serving in the army, and incorporated the swastika into the army's insignia. Although these were largely symbolic gestures, at the insistence of President Hindenburg, for example, Jewish war veterans could not be dismissed, and only some 70 soldiers were actually cashiered, they were still important concessions to Nazi ideology that indicated just how far the army had come to terms with the new political order. At the same time, however, the army was still by no means a Nazified institution. Its relative independence was underpinned by the close interest taken in its fortunes by Reich President Paul von Hindenburg, its formal commander-in-chief. Hindenburg indeed had refused to appoint Walter von Reichenau, the pro-Nazi choice of Hitler and Blumberg, to succeed the conservative and anti-Nazi Kurt von Hammerstein as head of the army when he retired. Instead, he had enforced the appointment of General Werner von Fritsch, a popular staff officer of strong conservative views, with a passion for horsemanship and a strict Protestant outlook on life. Unmarried, a workaholic, and narrowly military in outlook, Fritsch had the Prussian officer's arrogant contempt for the vulgarity of the Nazis. His conservative influence was backed by the head of the troop office, General Ludwig Beck, appointed at the end of 1933. Beck was a cautious, shy, and withdrawn man, a widower whose main recreation was also horse riding. With men such as Fritsch and Beck occupying two of the senior posts in the army leadership, there was no chance of the army yielding to pressure from the SA. Blumberg secured a meeting with Hitler and the leadership of the SA and SS on February 28, 1934, at which Rom was forced to sign an agreement that he would not try to replace the army with a brown shirt militia. Germany's military force of the future, declared Hitler emphatically, would be a professional and well-equipped army, for which the brown shirts could only act in an auxiliary capacity. After the army officers had left the following reception, Rom told his men that he was not going to obey the ridiculous corporal and threatened to send Hitler on leave. Such insubordination did not go unnoticed. Indeed, aware of his attitude, Hitler had already had him put under covert surveillance by the police. Competition with the SA led Blumberg and the military leaders to try and win Hitler's favor in a variety of ways. The army regarded the SA as a potential source of recruits, but it was worried by the prospect that this might lead to political infiltration, and scornful of the fact that the SA leadership included men who had been dishonorably discharged from the military. It preferred, therefore, to agitate for the reintroduction of conscription, embodying this in a plan drawn up by Beck in December 1933. Hitler had already promised that this would happen when he had talked to army leaders the previous February. He had told the British minister, Anthony Eden, indeed, that it would be a mistake to allow a second army to exist, and that he intended to bring the SA under control and to reassure foreign opinion by demilitarizing it. Yet despite this, stories of local and regional brown shirt commanders prophesying the creation of an SA state and a Knight of the Long Knives began to multiply. Max Heidebreck, an SA leader in Rummelsburg, was reported as saying, "Some of the officers of the army are swine. Most officers are too old and had to be replaced by young ones. We want to wait till Papa Hindenburg is dead, and then the SA will march against the army. What can 100,000 soldiers do against such a greatly superior force of SA men?" SA men began stopping army supplies in transit and confiscating weapons and supplies. Yet on the whole, such incidents were local, sporadic, and uncoordinated. Rome never devised a concerted plan. Contrary to later allegations by Hitler, he had no immediate intention of launching a putsch. Indeed, Rome announced at the beginning of June that he was going on a rest cure, on doctor's orders, to Bad Wiessa, near Munich, and sent the SA on leave for the whole of July. 2. The continued disturbances and radical rhetoric were enough to worry not just the army leaders, but also some of Hitler's conservative colleagues in the cabinet. Up to the passage of the Enabling Act, the cabinet had continued to meet regularly in order to pass draft decrees for forwarding to the president. From the end of March, however, it started to be bypassed by the Reich Chancellery and the individual ministries. Hitler did not like the extensive and sometimes critical discussions that a cabinet meeting involved. He preferred decrees to be worked out as fully as possible before they came to the full meeting of ministers. Increasingly, therefore, the cabinet met only to rubber stamp previously decided legislation. Up to the summer recess of 1933, it still met 4 or 5 times a month, and there were also relatively frequent meetings in September and October 1933. From November 1933, however, a distinct change could be noted. The cabinet met only once that month, 3 times in December, once in January 1934, twice in February, and twice in March. Then, it failed to convene in April 1934, met only once in May, and had no sessions at all in June. By this time, it had long since ceased to be dominated, even numerically, by the conservatives, since the Nazi propaganda chief Josef Goebbels had joined it as Reich propaganda minister in March 1933, to be followed by Rudolf Hess and Ernst Röhm on December 1st, and another Nazi, the education minister Bernhard Rust, on May 1st, 1934. The nationalist Alfred Hugenberg had resigned on June 29th, 1933, and had been replaced as agriculture minister by the Nazi Walter Dauré. The cabinet appointed by Hindenburg on January 30, 1933, had contained only 3 Nazis: Hitler himself, Wilhelm Frick, the interior minister, and Hermann Göring, as minister without portfolio. Of the 17 cabinet ministers in office in May 1934, however, a clear majority, 9, were long-term members of the Nazi Party. It had become clear, even to a man as prone to self-deception and political blindness as the conservative vice-chancellor Franz von Papen, that the original expectations with which he and his conservative colleagues had entered the cabinet on January 30, 1933, had been completely dashed. It was not they who were manipulating the Nazis, but the Nazis who were manipulating them, and intimidating and bullying them as well. Yet, astonishingly, Papen had by no means abandoned his dream, articulated openly during his period of office as chancellor in 1932, of a conservative restoration brought about with the mass support of the Nazi Party. His speechwriter, Edgar Jung, continued to argue in the summer of 1933 for a vision of the German Revolution that would involve the depoliticization of the masses, their exclusion from the running of the state. The rampant populism of the SA seemed a serious obstacle to the anti-democratic and elitist regime that Papen desired. Around the vice-chancellor, there gathered a group of young conservatives who shared these views. Meanwhile, the vice-chancellery became the destination of an increasing number of complaints from people of all kinds about Nazi violence and arbitrary behavior, giving Papen and his staff an increasingly negative view of the effects of the National Revolution, which they had so far backed, and turned his group rapidly into a focus for all kinds of discontent. By May 1934, Goebbels was complaining in his diary about Papen, who was rumored to have his eye on the presidency once the aged Hindenburg was dead. Other conservative members of the cabinet were not exempt from the Nazi propaganda chief's scorn either. "There has to be a real clear-up there as soon as possible," he wrote. There was an obvious danger that the Papen group, already under close police surveillance, would make common cause with the army. Indeed, Papen's press secretary, Herbert von Bossa, was beginning to establish active contact with critical generals and senior officers worried about the activities of the SA. Hindenburg, long a buffer between the army and the conservatives on the one hand and the leading Nazis on the other, was known to have become seriously ill in April 1934. It was soon clear that he was not going to recover. He retired to his landed estate in Neudeck, East Prussia, at the end of June to await the end. His passing would clearly create a moment of crisis for which the regime had to be prepared. The moment was all the more critical for the regime because, as many people were aware, the enthusiasm of the National Revolution in 1933 had discernibly fallen off a year later. The brown shirts were not the only section of the population to feel disappointment at the results. Social Democratic agents reported to the exiled party leadership in Prague that people were apathetic, constantly complaining, and telling endless political jokes about the Nazi leaders. Nazi meetings were poorly attended. Hitler was still widely admired, but people were even beginning to direct criticisms in this quarter, too. Many of the Nazis' promises had not been kept, and fears of a new inflation or a sudden war were leading to panic buying and hoarding in some places. The educated classes feared that the disorder caused by the stormtroopers might spill over into chaos or, worse, Bolshevism. The leading Nazis were aware that such mutterings of discontent could be heard beneath the apparently smooth surface of political life. In answer to questions from the American journalist Louis P. Lochner, Hitler went out of his way to stress the unconditional loyalty he required of his subordinates. Matters were coming to a head. The Prussian minister-president, Hermann Göring, himself a former leader of the SA, was now so concerned at the drift of events that he agreed to hand over control of the Prussian political police to Heinrich Himmler on April 20, 1934, enabling the ambitious young SS leader, already in charge of the political police in all other parts of Germany, to centralize the police apparatus in his own hands. The SA, of which the SS was at this point still nominally a part, was an obvious obstacle to the achievement of Himmler's aims. On a 4-day cruise in the naval vessel Deutschland off Norway in mid-April, Hitler, Blumberg, and top military officers seemed to have reached an agreement that the SA should be curbed. May passed, and the first half of June, without Hitler making an open move. Not for the first time, Goebbels began to feel frustrated at his master's seeming indecision. By late June, he was recording, "The situation is getting ever more serious. The leader must act, otherwise reaction will become too much for us." Hitler's hand was finally forced when Papen gave a public address at Marburg University on June 17, 1934, in which he warned against a second revolution and attacked the personality cult surrounding Hitler. It was time for the permanent upheaval of the Nazi revolution to come to an end, he said. The speech, written by Papen's advisor, Edgar Jung, mounted a strong attack on the selfishness, lack of character, insincerity, lack of chivalry, and arrogance at the heart of the so-called German Revolution. It was greeted with thunderous applause from his listeners. Shortly afterwards, appearing at a fashionable horse racing meeting in Hamburg, Papen was greeted by cheers and shouts of "Hail Marburg!" from the crowd. Back from a frustrating meeting with Mussolini in Venice, Hitler vented his spleen at Papen's activities before he had even learned of his vice-chancellor's speech in Marburg. Addressing the party faithful in Gera, Hitler attacked the little pygmies who were trying to stop the victory of the Nazi idea. "It is ridiculous when such a little worm tries to fight such a powerful renewal of the people. Ridiculous when such a little pygmy fancies himself capable of obstructing the gigantic renewal of the people with a few empty phrases." The clenched fist of the people, he threatened, would smash anyone who dares to make even the slightest attempt at sabotage. At the same time, the vice-chancellor's complaint to Hitler, coupled with a threat to resign, met with a promise that the SA's drive towards a second revolution would be stopped, and a suggestion, which Papen too readily accepted, that the whole situation should be discussed in due course with the ailing president. Not for the first time, Papen was lulled into a false sense of security by Hitler's disingenuous promises and a misplaced faith in Hindenburg's influence. Hitler rushed off to consult with Hindenburg. Arriving at Neudeck on June 21st, he was confronted by Blumberg, who had been discussing Papen's speech with the president. The army chief made it clear that if the brown shirts were not immediately brought to heel, Hindenburg would be prepared to declare martial law and put the government in the hands of the army. Hitler had no option but to act. He began planning Rome's overthrow. The political police, in collaboration with Himmler and his deputy, Reinhard Heinrich, head of the SS Security Service, began to manufacture evidence that Rome and his stormtroopers were planning a nationwide uprising. Leading officers in the SS were presented with the evidence on June 24th and given instructions on how to deal with the supposed putsch. Lists of the politically unreliable people were drawn up and local SS leaders informed that they would be called upon to kill a number of them, particularly any who resisted, when the day of action came, on June 30th. The army put its resources at the disposal of the SS for the eventuality of a serious conflict. "Woe betide anyone," warned Rudolf Hess in a radio broadcast on June 25th, "who thought to betray their loyalty to the Führer by carrying out revolutionary agitation from below." On June 27th, Hitler met with Blumberg and Reichenau to secure the army's cooperation. They responded by expelling Rome from the German Officers' League the next day and by putting the army on full alert. Blumberg published an article in the Nazis' flagship daily, the Racial Observer, on June 29th, declaring the army's absolute loyalty to the new regime. Meanwhile, it seems, Hitler learned that Hindenburg had agreed to give an audience to Papen, scheduled for June 30th, the day of the planned action against the SA. This confirmed the leading Nazis in their belief that the opportunity must be used to strike against the conservatives as well. Nervous and apprehensive, Hitler sought to allay suspicions by going to a wedding reception in Essen, from where he telephoned Rome's adjutant in his vacation hotel at Bad Wiessa, ordering the SA leaders to meet him there on the morning of June 30th. Hitler then organized a hurried conference in Bad Godesberg with Goebbels and Sepp Dietrich, the SS officer who commanded his personal bodyguard. He would act against Rome the next day, he told the astonished Goebbels, who had been expecting merely a blow against the reactionaries and had hitherto been kept in the dark about everything else. Goering was sent off to Berlin to take charge of the action there. Fantastic rumors began to circulate, and the SA itself began to be alarmed. Some 3,000 stormtroopers rampaged through the streets of Munich on the night of June 29th, shouting that they would crush any attempt to betray their organization and denouncing the leader and the army. Calm was eventually restored by Adolf Wagner, the regional leader of Munich, but there had been other similar demonstrations elsewhere. When Hitler learned of these events on flying into Munich airport at 4:30 on the morning of June 30, 1934, he decided that he could not wait for the planned conference of SA leaders at which he was going to launch the purge. Now there was not a minute to lose. 3. Hitler and his entourage drove first to the Bavarian Interior Ministry, where they confronted the leaders of the previous night's brown shirt demonstration in the city streets. In a rage, he shouted at them that they would be shot. Then he tore off their epaulets with his bare hands. As the chastened stormtroopers were taken off to Munich State Prison at Stadelheim, Hitler assembled a group of SS bodyguards and police and drove off in a convoy of saloon cars and convertibles to Bad Wiessa, where they entered the Hanselbauer Hotel. Accompanied by his head chauffeur, Julius Schreck, and followed by a group of armed detectives, Hitler marched up to the first floor. The brown shirts were still sleeping off a major drinking bout from the night before. Erich Kempka, who had driven Hitler to Wiessa, described what happened next. Taking no notice of me, Hitler enters the room where SA senior group leader Heinz is lodging. I hear him shout, "Heinz, if you are not dressed in 5 minutes, I'll have you shot on the spot." I take a few steps back, and a police officer whispers to me that Heinz has been in bed with an 18-year-old SA senior troop leader. Eventually, Heinz comes out of the room with an 18-year-old fair-haired boy mincing in front of him. "Into the laundry room with them," orders Schreck. Meanwhile, Rome comes out of his room in a blue shirt and with a cigar in the corner of his mouth. Hitler looks at him grimly but says nothing. Two detectives take Rome into the vestibule of the hotel, where he throws himself into an armchair and orders coffee from the barman. I stand in the corridor, a little to the side, and a detective tells me how Rome was arrested. Hitler had entered Rome's bedroom alone with a whip in his hand. Behind him had stood two detectives holding pistols with the safety catch removed at the ready. He had spat out the words, "Rome, you are under arrest." Rome had looked up sleepily out of the pillows on his bed. "Heil, my leader." "You are under arrest," Hitler had bawled for the second time. He had turned on his heel and left the room. Meanwhile, upstairs in the corridor, things have become very lively. SA leaders are coming out of their rooms and being arrested. Hitler shouts at each one, "Have you had anything to do with Rome's machinations?" Of course, none of them says yes, but that doesn't help them. Hitler mostly knows the answer himself. Now and then he turns to Goebbels or Lutze with question. And then comes his decision. Arrested. The brown shirts were locked in the hotel's linen cupboard and shortly afterwards taken off to Stadelheim. Hitler and his party followed them back to Munich. Meanwhile, leading brown shirts arriving at Munich's main railway station en route for the planned meeting were arrested by the SS as they got off the train. Back in Munich, Hitler drove to Nazi Party headquarters, which he had had sealed off by regular troops, and ranted against Rome and the brown shirt leaders, announcing that they were dismissed and would be shot. Undisciplined and disobedient characters and asocial or diseased elements would be annihilated. A senior brown shirt, Victor Lutze, who had been informing on Rome for some time and had accompanied Hitler to the Bad Wiessa Hotel, was named as the new leader of the SA. Rome, Hitler shouted, had been in the pay of the French. He was a traitor and had been conspiring against the state. The party faithful who had gathered to hear his diatribe yelled their assent. Ever obliging, Rudolf Hess volunteered to shoot the traitors personally. Privately, Hitler was reluctant to have Rome, one of his longest-serving supporters, put to death. Eventually, on July 1st, he sent word to him that he could have a revolver with which to kill himself. When Rome failed to make use of the opportunity, Hitler sent Theodor Eicke, the commandant of Dachau, and another SS officer from the camp to Stadelheim. Entering Rom's cell, the two SS officers gave him a loaded Browning and told him to commit suicide. If not, they would return in 10 minutes and finish him off themselves. On re-entering the cell after the time was up, they encountered Rom standing up, facing them with his chest bared in a dramatic gesture designed to emphasize his honor and loyalty. Without uttering a word, they immediately shot him dead at point-blank range. In addition, Hitler ordered the Silesian brown shirt Edmund Heinz, who in 1932 had led an uprising against the Nazi Party in Berlin, to be shot, along with the leaders of the Munich demonstration the night before, and three others. Other SA men were driven off to the concentration camp at Dachau, where they were badly beaten by SS guards. At 6 in the evening, Hitler flew off to Berlin to take charge of events in the city capital, where Hermann Göring had been implementing his orders with a ruthlessness that belied his widespread reputation as a moderate. Göring had not confined himself to carrying out the action against the brown shirt leaders. The atmosphere in Göring's office, where the Prussian minister-president was closeted with Heinrich and Himmler, was later described as one of blatant bloodthirstiness and hideous vindictiveness by a policeman who looked on as Göring shouted orders for people on the list to be killed. "Shoot them down! Shoot! Shoot at once!" and joined in bouts of raucous laughter with his companions as news of successful murder operations came in. Striding up and down the room in a white tunic, white boots, and gray-blue trousers, Göring ordered the storming of the vice-chancellery. Entering with an armed SS unit, Gestapo agents gunned down Papen's secretary, Herbert von Bossa, on the spot. The vice-chancellor's ideological guru, Edgar Jung, arrested on June 25th, was also shot. His body was dumped unceremoniously in a ditch. Papen himself escaped death. He was too prominent a figure to be shot down in cold blood. The assassination of two of his closest associates had to be warning enough. Papen was confined to his home for the time being, under guard, while Hitler pondered what to do with him. Other pillars of the conservative establishment did not fare so well. General von Schleicher, Hitler's predecessor as Reich Chancellor, and a man who had once described Hitler as unfit to hold office, was shot dead by the SS in his home, together with his wife. He was not the only army officer to be killed. Major General Kurt von Bredow, who was thought to have published criticisms of the regime abroad, was killed at his home, shot, the newspapers reported, while resisting arrest as a partner to Rome's infamous conspiracy. Apart from anything else, these killings served as a warning to the army leadership that they, too, would have to face the consequences if they did not toe the Nazi line. The former police chief and leader of Catholic Action, Erich Klausener, now a senior civil servant in the transport ministry, was shot down on Heinrich's orders as a warning to another former chancellor, Heinrich Brüning, who had been tipped off about the purge and had left the country. Klausener's murder sent a clear message to Catholics that a revival of independent Catholic political activity would not be tolerated. Subsequent claims by the Nazi leadership that men such as these had been involved in the Röhm revolt were pure invention. Most of these men had been listed by Edgar Jung as possible members of a future government, without actually having agreed to it or even known about it. Their mere inclusion on the list amounted to a death warrant for most of them. Gregor Strasser, the man whom many thought of as a possible figurehead for the Nazi Party in a restored conservative government, was targeted as well. A short time before Hitler's appointment as Reich Chancellor in January 1933, Strasser, the head of the Nazi Party's administration and the architect of many of its principal institutions, had resigned in despair at Hitler's refusal to enter any coalition government except as its head. Strasser had been negotiating at the time with Schleicher, and there had been rumors that he had been offered a position in Schleicher's cabinet late in 1932. Although he had lived in retirement since his resignation, Strasser continued to pose, in the minds of the leading Nazis, a potential threat as an acceptable coalition partner for the conservatives. He was also a longtime personal enemy of Himmler and Goering, and he had not been sparing in his criticism of them while he had been a member of the senior party leadership. Goering had him arrested and taken to police headquarters, where he was shot dead. Strasser's friend and collaborator, Paul Schultz, a former top official in the SA, was also sought up by Goering's emissaries and taken into a forest to be shot. On getting out of the car at the chosen place of execution, he made a dash for it and feigned dead when he was shot, though he was only lightly wounded. He made good his escape while his attackers went back to the car to get a sheet to wrap his body in, and later managed to negotiate his exile from Germany with Hitler personally. Another target who escaped was Captain Erhard, the Free Corps leader in the Kopp Putsch of 1920, who had helped Hitler in 1923. He fled as the police entered his home and eventually managed to cross the border into Austria. In Berlin, the action took on a different character from the events in Munich, where SA leaders from all over the country had been gathering on Hitler's orders. In Munich, the brown shirts were the principal target. In Berlin, the conservatives. The action was carefully planned in advance. Ernst Müller, the head of the SS Security Service in Breslau, was given a post-dated, sealed letter in Berlin on June 29th and sent back home on a private plane supplied by Goering. On the morning of June 30th, Heydrich ordered him by telephone to open it. It contained a list of brown shirt leaders to be eliminated, along with instructions to occupy the police headquarters and summon the leading SA men to a meeting. Further orders included the seizure of SA arms stores, the securing of airports and radio transmitters, and the occupation of SA premises. He followed his instructions to the letter. By the early evening, not only were the police cells in Breslau full, but also numerous other rooms were packed with bewildered brown-shirted prisoners as well. Heinrich phoned Müller repeatedly to demand the execution of those men on the list who had not already been disposed of in Munich. The men were taken to SS headquarters, their epaulets were removed, and they were driven out to a nearby forest and shot in the middle of the night. There were further arrests and shootings the next morning on July 1st. In the general climate of violence, Hitler and his underlings took the opportunity to settle old scores or eliminate personal rivals. Some, of course, were too grand to touch, notably General Erich Ludendorff, who had been causing some headaches for the Gestapo with his far-right anti-Freemasonry campaigns. The hero of the First World War was left alone. He was to die peacefully on December 20th, 1937, and to be granted respectful obsequies by the regime. But in Bavaria, the former minister-president Gustav Ritter von Kahr, who had played a key part in quelling the Hitler putsch in 1923, was cut to pieces by SS men. The music critic, Wilhelm Eduard Schmid, was also killed, in the mistaken belief that he was Ludwig Schmidt, a former supporter of Gregor Strasser's radical brother Otto, who had been forced to resign from the party because of his revolutionary views and had maintained a constant barrage of criticism of Hitler from the safety of exile ever since. The conservative Bavarian politician, Otto Ballerstedt, who had successfully prosecuted Hitler for breaking up a political meeting at which he had been speaking in 1921, resulting in the Nazi leader spending a month in Stadelheim, was arrested and shot in Dachau on July 1st. One senior SS officer, Erich von dem Bock-Zalewski, chose the moment to get rid of a hated rival, the SS cavalry leader, Anton Baron von Hoberg und Buchenwald, who was duly gunned down in his home. In Silesia, the regional SS boss, Udo von Vorisch, had his former rival, Emil Sembach, shot despite a prior agreement with Himmler that Sembach should be sent to Berlin to be dealt with. The violence spilled over into another unconnected area, too. Four Jews were arrested in Hirschberg and shot while trying to escape. The leader of the Jewish Veterans League in Glogau was taken out to a wood and shot dead. Despite such obviously personally motivated actions, The Nazis lost no time in pumping out propaganda justifications for the murders. Goebbels broadcast a lengthy account of the action the next day, alleging that Röhm and Schleicher had been conspiring to bring about a second revolution that would have plunged the Reich into chaos. "Every clenched fist that is raised against the leader and his regime," he warned, generalizing the action, potentially to every kind of opposition, "will be prized open by force if necessary." Despite this, Hitler still had a lot of explaining to do, not least to the army, two of whose senior officers he had had killed during the purge. Addressing the cabinet on July 3rd, Hitler alleged that Röhm had been plotting against him with Schleicher, Gregor Strasser, and the French government for over a year. He had been forced to act as these plots threatened to culminate in a putsch on June 30th. If there were legal objections to what he had done, then his answer was that due process was not possible in such circumstances. If a mutiny broke out on board a ship, the captain was not only entitled but also obliged to crush the mutiny right away. There was to be no trial, therefore, just a law to legalize the action retroactively, backed enthusiastically by Reich Justice Minister Gertner. The example that he has given would be a salutary lesson for the entire future. He had stabilized the authority of the Reich government for all time. In the press, Goebbels concentrated on underlining the breadth and depth of support for the action in order to reassure the public that order had been restored rather than undermined. The formal gratitude of Blumberg and Hindenburg was recorded in banner headlines, while other stories recorded declarations of loyalty from all over Germany and everywhere veneration and admiration for the leader. The events were generally described as a cleanup of dangerous and degenerate elements in the Nazi movement. Some of the brown shirt leaders, the press reported, had been found with catamites, and one was startled from his sleep in the most disgusting situation. When the Reichstag was convened on July 13th, Hitler elaborated on these remarks in a speech broadcast on the radio and blared out to the population in pubs, bars, and town squares across the land. Surrounded by steel-helmeted SS men, he presented his audience with an elaborate and fantastic web of claims and assertions about the supposed conspiracy to overthrow the Reich. "There were four groups of malcontents who had been involved," he said. "Communist street fighters who had infiltrated the SA, political leaders who had never reconciled themselves to the finality of January 30th, 1933, rootless elements who believed in permanent revolution, and upper-class drones who sought to fill their empty lives with gossip, rumor, and conspiracy. Attempts to curb the excesses of the SA had been frustrated," he now knew, "by the fact that they were all part of the mounting plot to overthrow public order. He had been forced to act without recourse to the law." He said, "If anyone reproaches me and asks why we did not call upon the regular courts for sentencing, my only answer is this. In that hour, I was responsible for the fate of the German nation and was thus the supreme judiciary of the German people. I gave the order to shoot those parties mainly responsible for this treason. The nation should know that no one can threaten its existence, which is guaranteed by inner law and order, and escape unpunished. And every person should know for all time that if he raises a hand to strike out at the state, certain death will be his lot." This open confession of the complete illegality of his action in formal terms did not run into any criticism from the judicial authorities. On the contrary, the Reichstag enthusiastically applauded Hitler's justification and passed a resolution thanking him for his action. State Secretary Meisner sent a telegram in the name of the ailing President Hindenburg giving his approval. A law was quickly passed, giving the action retroactive legality. Social Democratic agents reported that the events had initially created considerable confusion in the population. Anyone who openly criticized the action was immediately arrested. The press reported that the police had issued a sharp warning to subversives and malicious agitators. Concentration camp is threatened for rumor-mongering and offering slanderous insults of the movement itself and its leader. This wave of repression, which continued in the early part of August, left people apprehensive about the future, fearful of arrest. Many suspected that there was more to the events of June 30th than met the eye, and local police authorities reported an atmosphere of widespread rumor and speculation, grumbling and carping. The propaganda ministry noted with alarm, in an internal memorandum, the innumerable nonsensical rumors that are in circulation. The orchestrated press campaign that followed had little effect in countering such feelings. The divisions exposed by the conflict led to optimistic talk among former Social Democrats and German nationalists that Hitler will soon be finished. Most people, however, were at least relieved that Hitler had acted against the brown bigwigs, and that the streets, as it seemed, would now be safe from the excesses of drunken and disorderly stormtroopers. Not untypical was the reaction of the conservative Hamburg schoolteacher, Luisa Zollmeitz, who had been so enthusiastic for the coalition cabinet and the day of Potsdam in 1933. "That great, unforgettable, beautiful German day," she had written. Only to become worried about the possible socialist tendencies of the regime when it began to confiscate the assets of emigre Jews like Albert Einstein. She wrote, "They should not do that. Don't confuse the concept of property. Bolshevism without it." Like many others, she described June 30th, 1934 as a day that has shattered all of us right down to our innermost heart. Half persuaded by the moral transgressions of some of the murdered men, a disgrace for the whole of Germany. She spent her time swapping rumors with friends and listening breathlessly to the radio in a friend's house for the latest news. As details began to emerge, she found herself overcome with admiration for Hitler's conduct. The personal courage, the decisiveness and effectiveness he showed in Munich, the decisiveness and effectiveness that is unique. She compared him to Frederick the Great of Prussia or Napoleon. The fact that, as she noted, there was no trial, no drumhead court-martial, seemed only to increase her admiration. She was fully persuaded that Rome had been planning an uprising together with Schleicher. This was the last of the widely mistrusted former chancellor's many political adventures, Luisa Zollmeitz noted. Her credulity and relief were typical of the majority of middle-class Germans after the initial hours of confusion. They had supported Hitler not least because, by the middle of 1933, he had restored order on the streets and stability to the political scene, and now he had achieved this a second time. The day after the action, crowds gathered in front of the Reich Chancellery and the propaganda ministry, singing the Horst Wessel song, and protesting their loyalty to the leader, though whether it was enthusiasm, nervousness, or relief that prompted them to do this is uncertain. Hitler's own standing was widely agreed to have been strengthened by his swift and decisive action. It contrasted even more sharply than before in the minds of many with the disorder and radicalism of the party. Some, like the former Social Democrat Jochen Klemper, were shocked by the murder of Schleicher's wife, who could not possibly have been suspected of anything. Only the more disaffected commented sourly that the only thing wrong with the purge was that too few Nazis had been executed. The scale of the purge had been considerable. Hitler himself told the Reichstag on July 13, 1934, that 74 people had been killed, while Goering alone had had over 1,000 people arrested. At least 85 people are known to have been summarily killed, without any formal legal proceedings being taken against them. 12 of the dead were Reichstag deputies. The SA leaders and their men had been almost wholly unsuspecting. Many of them, indeed, went to their deaths believing their arrest and execution had been ordered by the army and swearing eternal loyalty to the leader. In the following days and weeks, arrests and dismissals continued, directed in particular against the rowdiest and most corrupt elements among the brown shirts. heavy drinking, homosexuality, embezzlement, riotous behavior. All the things that had lent the brown shirts such public notoriety over the previous months were ruthlessly purged. Drunken brawls involving Nazi stormtroopers still occurred thereafter, but no more on the dangerous scale of the months before June 30, 1934. Disillusioned, without a role, and unable to assert themselves anymore, the brown shirts began leaving the organization en masse. 100,000 in August and September in 1934 alone. From a total membership of 2.9 million on August 1934, the SA declined to 1.6 million in October 1935 and 1.2 million in April 1938. Strict entry requirements and quotas limited recruitment. The decline of unemployment and, from 1935, the introduction of conscription also took away many of the young men who might otherwise have joined. Yet although they no longer threatened the army or the state, the brown shirts' potential for violence and aggression survived. A report by one SA leader of events in the brown shirts' camp during a single night at the Nuremberg rally in 1934 indicates this very clearly. "Everyone was drunk," he noted, "and a large fight between two regional groups at 1 a.m. left several men with knife wounds. On their way back to the camp, stormtroopers attacked cars, threw bottles and stones at the windows, and beat up their occupants. The entire Nuremberg police force was mobilized to try and stop the mayhem. A brown shirt was hauled out of the camp latrine, into which he had fallen in a drunken stupor, but he died of chlorine gas poisoning shortly afterwards. The camp was not quiet until 4 a.m, by which time 6 men had been killed and 30 wounded, as well as another 20 who had been injured by jumping on and off cars and trucks, hanging onto the sides, or falling off the back while the vehicle was moving." Such incidents repeated themselves on other occasions. Chastened, reduced in numbers, deprived of its autonomy and, so the Nazi leaders claimed, purged of its most extreme, violent, and corrupt elements, the SA nevertheless remained a source of violence whenever the regime chose to make use of it, and sometimes even when it did not. Meanwhile, the army breathed a sigh of relief. General Blumberg expressed his gratitude and assured Hitler of the complete devotion of the army. He congratulated Hitler on his soldierly decision to deal with traitors and murderers. General von Reichenau quickly explained away the cold-blooded murder of one of the army's most senior and publicly prominent officers, Kurt von Schleicher, in a communique that claimed he had been conspiring with Rome and with foreign powers to overthrow the state, and had been shot when he had offered armed resistance to his arrest. Whether his wife, also shot, had been involved, he did not say. Army officers uncorked bottles of champagne in the mess to celebrate. From young firebrands like Lieutenant Klaus von Stauffenberg, who described the action as the lancing of a boil, to senior officers like Major General Erwin von Witzelben, who told his fellow officers he wished he had been there to see Rome shot, all of them rejoiced to a degree that even Blumberg found unseemly. Only one man, a retired captain and former senior civil servant in the Reich Chancellery, Erwin Planck, thought the army's jubilation misplaced. "If you look on without lifting a finger," he told General von Fritsch, "you will meet the same fate sooner or later." Repression and Resistance. 1. While these events had been in progress, Reich President Hindenburg's condition had been steadily deteriorating. When Hitler visited him on August 1st in Neudeck, the head of state and former First World War military leader, in a confusion that graphically symbolized the shift in the balance of power and authority between the two men that had taken place over the previous 18 months, addressed him as Majesty, evidently thinking he was talking to the Kaiser. Noting the old man's physical and mental dissolution, Hindenburg's doctors told Hitler that the president only had 24 hours to live. Flying back to Berlin, Hitler convened a cabinet meeting the same evening. Without waiting for the old man to die, the cabinet agreed to decree merging the offices of president and chancellor and transferring all the powers of the former to the latter, to come into effect at the moment of Hindenburg's passing. Hitler did not have long to wait. At 9 a.m. on August 2, 1934, the president finally gave up the ghost. Many conservative Germans felt that this was the end of an era. He was, noted Luisa Zollmeitz in her diary, a real fighter and blameless human being, and has carried his, our, era with him into the grave. He took his office with him to the grave, too. The title of Reich President, Hitler announced, was inseparably united with the name of the great deceased. It would be wrong for it to be used again. In future, Hitler would be known as the leader and Reich Chancellor. A law was put forward to this effect and ratified by a nationwide plebiscite held on August 19th. With this act, Hitler became head of state in every sense of the term. The most important attribute of this office was the fact that it was to the head of state that the armed forces swore allegiance. On August 2, 1934, troops all over the land were summoned and made to swear a new oath, devised by General von Reichenau, without any consultation with Hitler himself. The old oath had pledged allegiance to the abstract entity of the Weimar Constitution and the unnamed person of the president. The new one was very different. I swear by God this holy oath that I will render unconditional obedience to the leader of the German Reich and people, Adolf Hitler, the supreme commander of the armed forces, and as a brave soldier am willingly prepared to risk my life for this oath at any time. Nor was this a merely formal pledge, for the oath of allegiance was of far more importance in the German army than in most of its equivalents elsewhere. It was the subject of specific training and education sessions, in which duty and honor were emphasized and examples given of the consequences of breaking it. Most important of all, perhaps, was the novel inclusion of the pledge to unconditional obedience to Hitler, whether or not his commands might have been considered legal, in contrast to the primacy given by the previous oath of allegiance to the Constitution and the lawful establishments of the German nation. A few officers in the military were fully aware of what the oath meant. Some had doubts. The evening after swearing the oath, Major General Ludwig Beck, the conservative, hard-working, middle-class artillery officer, who had risen by 1934 to become a senior staff officer at the head of the troop office, renamed the Army General Staff in 1935, described August 2nd as the blackest day of my life. But most were either in favor, given the way in which Hitler had fulfilled the Army's wishes over the previous 18 months, or remained unaware of the oath's potential significance. Hitler himself had no doubt as to the importance of what had been done. After promulgating a law on August 20, 1934, giving retroactive legal validity to the new oath, he wrote a fulsome letter of thanks to Werner von Blumberg, the Minister of Defense, expressing his gratitude and promising that the Army's loyalty would be reciprocated. Gratified in his turn, Blumberg ordered that the armed forces would now address Hitler as "my leader," instead of the civilian appellation of "Mr. Hitler," which they had previously used. The military oath provided the model for a similar oath ordered in the law of August 20th to be sworn by civil servants. Once more, it was to the leader of the German Reich and people, an office unknown in any constitution, a form of authority derived from Hitler's person rather than from the German state. These events cemented Hitler's power as the leader. As the young constitutional lawyer, Ernst Rudolf Huber, explained in 1939, this was not a governmental office, but derived its legitimation from the united will of the people. He wrote, "The authority of the leader is total and all-embracing, Within it, all resources available to the body politic merge. It covers every facet of the life of the people. It embraces all members of the German community, pledged to loyalty and obedience to the leader. The leader's authority is subject to no checks or controls. It is circumscribed by no private preserves of jealously guarded individual rights. It is free and independent, overriding and unfettered. Hitler's opinion, Huber declared, in his treatment of the constitutional law of the Greater German Reich, which quickly became a standard work, represented the objective will of the people, and in this way he could counter misguided public opinion and override the selfish will of the individual. Hitler's word, as another commentator, Werner Best, a Nazi intellectual who had been the central figure in the Boxheim affair in 1931, noted, was thus law, and could override all existing laws. He was not given his powers by the state, but by history. In time, therefore, his merely constitutional secondary title of Reich Chancellor was quietly dropped. Not just Hitler personally, but also the Nazi movement in general, had always held the letter of the law and the institutions of the state in contempt. From the very beginning, they had operated extra-legally, and this continued even after they had abandoned the idea of a direct putsch as the way to power. For the Nazis, the bullet and the ballot box were complementary tools of power, not alternatives. Votes and elections were treated cynically as instruments of formal political legitimation. The will of the people was expressed not through the free articulation of public opinion, but through the person of Hitler and the Nazi movement's incorporation of the historical destiny of the Germans, even if the Germans themselves disagreed with this. Moreover, widely accepted legal norms, such as the notion that people should not commit murder or acts of violence, destruction and theft, were disregarded from the outset by the Nazis because they believed that history and the interests of the German Aryan race justified extreme measures in the crisis that followed Germany's defeat in the war. At the same time, at least in the early years of the Third Reich, the massive apparatus of state bureaucracy, judiciary, police, penal and welfare systems inherited from the Weimar Republic, and ultimately to a large extent from the Bismarckian Reich, could not simply be brushed aside or overridden at will. There existed what the exiled political scientist Ernst Frankl called the dual state, to quote the title of his famous book, published in the USA in 1941. On the one hand was the normative state, bound by rules, procedures, laws, and conventions, and consisting of formal institutions, such as the Reich Chancellery, the ministries, local authorities, and so on. And on the other, there was the prerogative state, an essentially extra-legal system that derived its legitimation entirely from the supra-legal authority of the leader. Theorists like Huber distinguished carefully between the authority of the state and the authority of the leader, and made it clear that the latter always had precedence over the former. Thus, formerly illegal acts, such as the murders committed in the Night of the Long Knives, were sanctioned by the leader's authority and so, in fact, were not illegal at all. The arrests, imprisonments, and murders had been carried out not by the police or the regular law enforcement agencies, but by the SS, and the formal apparatus of the law and the state almost fell over itself in the rush to give these acts of violence the approval of the law. This was a graphic demonstration of the fact that there was increasingly little serious conflict between the normative and prerogative systems in Nazi Germany. The former had to defer more and more to the latter, and as time went on, it became increasingly permeated by its spirit. Rules were relaxed, laws dispensed with, scruples abandoned. Already at the beginning of July 1933, Hans Heinrich Lemaire's, head of the Reich Chancellor's office, was beginning to sign his letters Hail Hitler, or Heil Hitler. Towards the end of the month, all civil servants, including university teachers, lawyers, and other state employees, were instructed to use the German greeting when conducting official business. Not to say Hail Hitler or give the Nazi salute when the occasion seemed to demand it, was from this point on an overt sign of dissidence. These were only the outward signs of a compliance that increased rapidly in intensity as the regime settled down into power. Ministers such as Franz Gertner, who had been Reich Justice Minister in the last two cabinets before Hitler's and continued in office under the Third Reich, still made strenuous efforts to try and get the arbitrary authority of the leader mediated through formal acts of law. This required the repeated invention of phrases and concepts designed to make it look, retrospectively, as if Hitler's orders were in conformity with existing legal rules and regulations. In some cases, as with the Night of the Long Knives, it also meant the passing of legislation giving retroactive legality to the regime's most blatantly illegal acts. On December 1, 1933, the supremacy of the prerogative over the normative state was formally proclaimed in a Law for Guarantees of the Unity of Party and State, though the vague terms in which the legislation was couched meant that it had little real effect in practice. In reality, this situation meant that there was continual skirmishing between the organs of party and state, with Nazi bosses interfering with state policy and decision-making at every level, from local authorities upwards. Hitler tried to control the interference by Nazi party regional leaders and other party officials in the business of the state in 1934 in particular, as they threatened to disrupt economic policy in some areas. He declared the party to be mainly an instrument of propaganda now that the state was in Nazi hands, but this too, in the end, meant very little. To begin with, Hitler also introduced a number of measures to make the party more effective. The decentralization of its organization after the resignation of Gregor Strasser at the end of 1932 was creating problems. Constant faction fighting and struggles for power within the party organization allowed clever civil servants to reduce the party's influence by playing off the factions against one another. Anxious to centralize the party again without putting power in the hands of a potential rival, Hitler first made the ever-faithful Rudolf Hess leader's deputy for party affairs, but without control over the organizational apparatus. Then on December 1, 1933, he appointed him to a cabinet post. On July 27, 1934, Hitler decreed that all laws and decrees proposed by Reich ministries had to pass through Hess's office. In 1935, Hess got the power to vet senior civil service appointments and promotions as well. All this gave the party very extensive influence over the state. Hess himself was scarcely capable of wielding it. He had no serious ambitions apart from abnegating himself to Hitler's will. His powers were increasingly used, however, by the undoubtedly ambitious Martin Bormann, chief of staff in Hess's office since July 1, 1933. Bormann created an elaborate apparatus of the staff of the leader's deputy, organized into different departments and manned by loyal supporters who shared his determination to centralize the party and use it systematically to create policy and push it through the civil service. In 1935, Bormann took over the management of Hitler's rural headquarters on the Obersalzberg in Bavaria. He used his presence there to act as Hitler's private secretary and exert growing control over access to the leader. It was typical of the way the Third Reich was run that Bormann's office now rivaled the official state institution of the Reich Chancellery, run by the top civil servant, Hans Heinrich Lammers. When Hitler was in Berlin, Lammers had more access and thus more influence. But the leader spent increasing amounts of time on the Obersalzberg, where Bormann could deny access, even to Lammers himself. This kind of duality was repeated at every level. As the chaos of the seizure of power in the first half of 1933 subsided, The Third Reich was left with a mass of competing institutions across the board. Reich governors, minister presidents, and regional leaders all competed for supremacy in the Federated States and in Prussia, which covered over half the land surface of Germany, with the regional state governors as well. These clashes were partly solved by the appointment of the top regional leader of every federated state as Reich governor in his particular area in April 1933. Another step was taken on January 30, 1934, when, under pressure from the Reich Interior Ministry under the Nazi Wilhelm Frick, a new law abolished all federated states, from Prussia downwards, along with their governments and parliaments, and merged their ministries into the corresponding Reich ministries. Thus, the federal constitution, which in one form had characterized the German political system for over 1,000 years, and was to do so again after 1945, was swept away. Characteristically, however, some elements of federalism remained, so the process of dissolution was incomplete. The party regional leaders retained their position as regional Reich governors and continued to occupy powerful positions within the party hierarchy. They wielded considerable influence over local and regional affairs, though here the Reich Local Government Law of 1935, in abolishing local elections, placed the appointment of mayors largely within the competence of the Interior Ministry in Berlin. This in turn aroused the hostility of the district leaders of the party, who often exploited the right of participation accorded them by the law in the appointment of local officials to interfere in local government and place their cronies and clients in offices for which they were often quite unsuited. None of this infighting, needless to say, involved any real opposition to the Nazi leadership or its policies. After the purges of 1933, the vast majority of state bureaucrats were themselves either Nazi Party members or broadly sympathetic to the movement. The heads of some of the key ministries in Berlin were the same. Their position was reinforced by such leading figures in the movement as Hermann Göring, who managed characteristically to prevent most of the proposed changes in the administration of the Prussian state from being put into effect. Indeed, the opposition of the regional leaders, among others, ensured that the whole reform never went as far as the Reich Interior Ministry intended, so that the administrative structures of the federated states remained largely intact, even after most aspects of their autonomy and all remaining vestiges of their representative institutions had been abolished. There was nothing neat about the administration of the Third Reich, and the idea that it was a smoothly functioning, completely centralized state has long since been abandoned by historians. Instead, the mess of competing institutions and conflicting competencies effectively prevented the normative state machine from asserting itself against the arbitrary interventions of the prerogative apparatus and doomed it to a slow decline in its power and autonomy. Meanwhile, after the upheavals of the summer and early autumn of 1934, Hitler moved quietly to make arrangements for the eventuality that he himself might be incapacitated or struck down unexpectedly. It was not Hess, nor was it Himmler, who had played the key role in the Night of the Long Knives, but the redoubtable, ruthless, and decisive figure of Hermann Göring. On December 7, 1934, Hitler issued a decree making Göring his deputy in all aspects of national government, should he be unable to carry out his duties himself. Göring's position as the second man in the Third Reich was cemented a few days later by another law, issued on December 13th, in which Hitler named Göring as his successor, and instructed the civil service, the army, the SA, and the SS, to swear an oath of personal allegiance to him immediately after his own death. Göring was to use this position in the next few years to build up a position for himself in the Third Reich so powerful, it has been said, as to amount to a state within the state. What his designation as Hitler's deputy and successor also showed, however, was how quickly after Hindenburg's death, the real and formal distribution of power within the Third Reich had become a matter of personalities, rather than constitutional rules and regulations. This was now a fully-fledged dictatorship, in which the leader could do as he wished, including naming his own successor without reference to anyone else. 2. Nowhere was the personal nature of Hitler's authority clearer than in the rise to prominence and power of the SS. Originating as Hitler's private bodyguard, the Protection Squad, in German Schutzstaffel, hence the abbreviation SS, it owed allegiance solely to him and obeyed no laws apart from its own. Heinrich Himmler, its leader since 1929, had built it up rapidly, until it reached a strength of over 50,000 by the spring of 1933. From this large force, Hitler once more selected an elite to form a new headquarters guard, renamed Adolf Hitler's Bodyguard in September 1933. Other elite groups of SS men were put into special detachments to be placed at Hitler's disposal for particular tasks of policing, terror, and operations such as the Night of the Long Knives. Already by 1934, Himmler was thinking of the SS in more ambitious terms than just a special force of loyal troops to be used by Hitler whenever he needed them. He conceived the ambition of turning the SS into the core elite of the new Nazi racial order. In deliberate contrast to the plebeian disorder of the brown shirts, Himmler intended his SS to be strictly disciplined, puritanical, racially pure, unquestioningly obedient, incorporating what he regarded as the best elements in the German race. Bit by bit, the older generation of SS men, with histories of violence often going back to the Freikorps of the early years of the Weimar Republic, were pensioned off, to be replaced by a younger, better educated generation of officers. Himmler created an elaborate hierarchy of SS officers, each level with its own grandiose-sounding title, such as Senior Group Leader, Standard Leader, and so on, and its own subtle indications of status in the insignia borne on the smart military-style uniforms all the officers wore. These redesigned uniforms included now not only the original silver death's head badge of the organization, but also a pseudo-runic version of the letters SS, shaped like a double bolt of lightning. SS typewriters were soon supplied with a special key carrying the runic title to use in official correspondence and memoranda. More grades and insignia followed. Himmler even raised money for his organization by doling out honorary ranks and titles such as sponsoring member to donors, and money duly began to flow in from industrialists, bankers, and businessmen. The Friends of the Reich Leader SS, another source of funds, included men like the banker Friedrich Flick, the IG Farben director, Heinrich Butefisch, and representatives of firms like Siemens Schuckert, the Deutsche Bank, Rheinmetall Borsig, and the Hamburg American Shipping Line. Many of these men received honorary SS titles as a reward. This, as they no doubt realized, was more than an empty gesture, since their association with the SS could protect them from interference by overzealous members of the party in their business. Not surprisingly, the magazine started by Himmler for his friends had a circulation of 365,000 by September 1939, and the collective financial contributions of the friends ranged between 500,000 and 1,000,000 Reichsmarks a year. All this threatened to dilute the close-knit elite character of the SS, so between 1933 and 1935, Himmler expelled no fewer than 60,000 men from its swollen ranks. In particular, he purged homosexuals, alcoholics, and men who had obviously joined out of opportunism and were less than fully convinced Nazis. Above all, from 1935, he required proof of pure Aryan ancestry, as he termed it, going back to 1800 for the rank and file, 1750 for officers. Serving and aspirant SS men combed the parish registers for proof of their racial purity, or hired professional genealogists to do it for them. Recruits now had to undergo a physical examination to confirm their Aryan qualities. Himmler considered that, in time, with suitably directed racial evolution, only blonde men would be accepted. Already since 1931, every SS man had to receive special permission from Himmler or his office to get married. It would only be granted if his fiancée was racially suitable as well. But these plans fell far short of the ideal. For example, out of 106,304 SS men who applied for marriage certificates issued from 1932 to 1940, only 950 were turned down, despite the fact that all the requirements were satisfied by only 7,518. The few hundred men who were expelled for contravening the marriage rules were subsequently reinstated. The new racial elite would clearly be a long time in coming. The elite formed by the SS gradually came to acquire a different characteristic from the racial supremacy originally intended by Himmler. It was, above all, and in sharp contrast to the SA, highly educated. Senior SS figures like Werner Best, Otto Ohlendorf, Walter Schellenberg, and Franz Zix possessed university degrees, even doctorates. Born in the run-up to the First World War, they were too young to have fought at the front, but were imbued instead with the compensatory nationalist fanaticism that was so prevalent in the universities they attended during the 1920s. Coming to maturity in an era of uncertainty, in which the political system was in flux, money, for a time at least, had lost its value, and a steady job or a stable career seemed out of the question, they had lost their moral compass, perhaps even never acquired one in the first place. To such young men, only the Nazi movement appeared to offer a solid identity, moral certainties, and a perspective on the future. Typical of this generation was Otto Ohlendorf, who was born in 1907 into a well-off Protestant farming family of conservative, nationalist political inclinations. Ohlendorf joined the Brown Shirts in 1925 while still attending grammar school, and was transferred to the SS in 1927 when he also joined the Nazi Party. From 1928 to 1931, he studied law and political science at the universities of Leipzig and Göttingen. Then he spent a year at the University of Pavia in order to learn about Italian fascism. The experience left him disillusioned with the rigidities of the corporate state, but also directed his attention towards economics, which he began to study seriously, although his attempts to take a doctorate and build an academic career for himself failed. From 1936 onwards, he concentrated on developing his ideas within the SS, where he became director of the economics section of the SS Security Service, or SD, where his attacks on Nazi economics for damaging the middle classes got him into trouble, but also won him a reputation for intelligence and assertiveness. It was probably these abilities, denoting a willingness to digest and articulate unpalatable truths, that in September 1939 secured him the position of Director of the German-speaking areas covered by security service operations. The security service itself had its origins in reports early in 1931 that the Nazi Party had been infiltrated by its enemies. Himmler established the security service to investigate the claims and put the business in the hands of a man who subsequently became perhaps more universally and cordially feared and disliked than any other leading figure in the Nazi regime, Reinhard Heydrich. Born in 1944 into a highly cultured middle-class family, his father was an opera singer, his mother an actress. Heydrich was an accomplished violinist who, contemporaries reported, played with feeling, often weeping as he did so. Tall, slim, blonde, his striking good looks marred for some only by his narrow face and small, close-set eyes. He also became an expert swordsman who excelled at fencing. joining the Free Corps at the age of 16, he enlisted as an officer cadet in the Navy in 1922 and had become a lieutenant by 1928, working in the signals department. His future in the armed forces had seemed assured. But Heydrich also found it easy to make enemies. The sailors disliked his abrupt, overbearing manner and mocked his high, almost falsetto voice. His numerous affairs with women got him into trouble with his superiors when the father of one of his girlfriends, a director of I.G. Farben, and a friend of Admiral Rader, head of the Navy, complained. Not only was the girl pregnant, but at the Naval Court of Honor summoned to hear the case, Heydrich tried to pin the blame for the conception on her, causing general outrage amongst the officers and leading to his being cashiered from the Navy in April 1931. Marrying his new girlfriend, Lena von Osten, who held strong Nazi convictions and had family connections with the SS chief in Munich, Karl Baron von Eberstein, Heydrich found new employment in the SS and was immediately set to work rooting out infiltrators. So thorough was he at this new task that he convinced Himmler that the security service needed to widen the scope of its activities to become the core of a new German police and surveillance force. His intrusive investigations aroused the hostility of a number of old Nazis, including the regional leader of Halle-Merseburg, who were posted with the malicious allegation that Heydrich had Jewish ancestry in his blood. An investigation ordered by Gregor Strasser, Reich organization leader of the Nazi Party at the time, came to the conclusive finding that the allegations were untrue, though they continued to dog Heydrich for the rest of his career and have surfaced periodically since his death as well. None of this stopped Heydrich's meteoric rise to power within the SS. Unsentimental, cold, efficient, power-hungry, and utterly convinced that the end justified the means, he soon won Himmler over to his ambitious vision of the SS and its security service as the core of a comprehensive new system of policing and control. Already on March 9, 1933, the two men took over the Bavarian police service, making the political section autonomous and moving SS security service personnel into some of the key posts. They went on to take over the political police service in one federated state after another, with the backing of the centralizing Reich Interior Minister, Wilhelm Frick. At this point, they ran into a major obstacle to their plan to create a unified national political police system, however, in the formidable shape of Hermann Göring, the Prussian minister-president, who, on November 30, 1933, established a separate political police service for Prussia. This was based on the political police section of the Berlin Police Presidium, which had acted as an information-gathering center on communists during the Weimar Republic and was staffed by professional policemen, headed by the career police officer, Rudolf Diels. Göring's new independent force was known as the Secret State Police, or Gestapo. The conflicts that rumbled on through the early months of 1934 were eventually resolved by the need felt by Göring to counter what he saw as the growing menace of Rome's brown shirts. Diels had implemented Nazi policy with gusto in the course of 1933, but his professional detachment was unsuited to the task of fighting the brown shirts by fair means or foul. On April 20, 1934, Göring replaced Diels with Himmler at the head of the Gestapo. Himmler and Heydrich now played off Göring and Frick against each other, and gained further room for maneuver thanks to the cutting of the formal ties that bound the SS to the SA after the Night of the Long Knives. Göring and Frick were forced to recognize that they were unable to control the Gestapo, whatever the formal powers they might claim to possess over it. While Göring effectively abandoned his efforts in November 1934, Frick and the Interior Ministry continued the bureaucratic struggle. It was finally resolved in Himmler's favor in 1936. A new law, passed on February 10th, took the Gestapo out of the jurisdiction of the courts, so that there could henceforth be no appeal to any outside body against its actions. Then, a decree, issued by Hitler on June 17th, made Himmler chief of the German police. In this capacity, Himmler put Heydrich in charge of the Gestapo and the criminal police, as well as the SS security service, while the uniformed police were also run by an SS man, Kurt De Lucke. Police and SS began, in effect, to merge, with professional policemen now joining the SS in increasing numbers, and SS men taking up an increasing number of posts within the police force. Thus, a key law enforcement agency in the Reich began to move decisively from the normative to the prerogative state, a transition symbolized in 1939 by the subordination of the SS Security Service and the Security Police to the Reich Security Head Office, controlled from the top by Himmler and Heydrich. 3. The Third Reich's elaborate apparatus of policing and repression was directed in the first place at hunting down and apprehending Nazism's enemies within Germany. Organized opposition to Nazism was offered only by the communists and the Social Democrats in the early years of the dictatorship. The left-wing political parties had won 13.1 million votes in Germany's last fully free election in November 1932, to the Nazis 11.7 million. They represented a huge chunk of the German electorate, yet they had no effective means of standing up to Nazi violence. Their entire apparatus, along with that of their paramilitary wings, the Red Front Fighters League and the Reichsbanner, and associated organizations such as the trade unions, was ruthlessly swept aside in the first months of 1933, their leaders exiled or imprisoned, their millions of members and supporters, many of them looking back on a lifetime's commitment to the cause, isolated and disoriented. Former activists were placed under more or less permanent surveillance, shadowed, their correspondence and contacts monitored. Divided, mutually hostile, and taken by surprise at the speed and ruthlessness of the Nazi seizure of power, they were initially helpless and uncertain how to act. Reorganizing to form an effective resistance movement seemed out of the question. Yet, in some ways, the Social Democrats and communists were better prepared for resistance than any other groups in Nazi Germany. The labor movement had been repeatedly banned or suppressed in the past, under Metternich's police repression of the early 19th century, in the post-revolutionary reaction of the 1850s and early 1860s, and most notably during Bismarck's anti-socialist law of 1878 to 1890. Going underground was nothing new. Indeed, some veterans of the anti-socialist law, when the Social Democrats had developed a whole network of secret contacts and communications, were still active 40-odd years later under the Nazis. Fueled by their stories of heroism and derring do in the 1880s, and disillusioned with the compromises the party had made in the later years of the Weimar Republic, many younger Social Democrats relished the prospect of returning to the party's revolutionary traditions. Where the international statesman Bismarck had failed to crush them, surely the beer hall demagogue Hitler was unlikely to succeed. Social Democratic activists quickly began cyclostyling illegal broadsheets, pamphlets, and newspapers, and distributing them secretly amongst sympathizers to try and strengthen their resolve to resist the new regime's attempts to win them over. Many were sustained by the belief, rooted in the Marxist theory that still dominated the thinking of the Social Democrats in this period, that the Nazi regime was unlikely to last. It was a final desperate attempt at self-preservation by a capitalist system plunged into its deepest ever crisis by the crash of 1929. All that was needed was to stick together and prepare for the Third Reich to self-destruct. By spreading clear and accurate information about the true state of affairs in Germany, it would be possible to destroy the ideological foundations of the regime and get the masses poised to remove it. In many parts of Germany, above all in its industrial heartlands, with their decades-old traditions of labor movement solidarity Clandestine groups quickly organized and sprang into action. Even in less secure cultural environments, social democrats managed to regroup and continue their activities in secret. In Hanover, for instance, the young Werner Blumenberg, later to make a name for himself as a Marx scholar, set up a socialist front that counted some 250 members and produced a series of mimeographed newsletters, the Socialist Flysheets, in editions of 1,500 that were distributed to contacts throughout the region. Similar smaller groups were established in the Bavarian towns of Augsburg and Regensburg, and even in the capital of the Nazi movement, Munich. Their activities included such actions as pasting up posters in the streets at night and urging people to vote no in the plebiscite of August 19, 1934. Leaflets were left in workplaces with slogans or brief news items criticizing the Nazi propaganda machine's portrayal of events. All over Germany, thousands of former activists in the Social Democratic Party were engaged in this kind of work. They concentrated in particular on maintaining contacts with the party's leadership in exile, in Prague. Their aim was not just to rouse the masses, but to keep old party and trade union loyalists within the fold and wait for better times. Most of them lived a double life, maintaining outward conformity with the regime, but engaging in resistance activities in secret, in their spare time. Some collected the leaflets and newspapers the exiled party organization printed, such as the New Forwards, on journeys across the border, smuggled them into Germany, and distributed them to the remnants of the party's membership. And they fed detailed information to the exiled leadership about the situation in Germany in turn, providing it month by month with a remarkably sober and increasingly realistic assessment of the chances of staging a revolt. Yet these activities stood little chance even of achieving the most basic of their aims, that of maintaining solidarity amongst former social democrats, let alone of spreading the resistors' message to the masses. For this, there were many reasons. The resistors lacked leadership. The most prominent social democrats had mostly gone into exile. Even those who wanted to stay on were too well known to escape the attention of the police for long. The Silesian Reichstag deputy Otto Buchwitz, for example, had a number of narrow escapes while traveling around Germany distributing illegal party literature, before he finally bowed to the inevitable and allowed the underground movement to smuggle him into Denmark at the beginning of August 1933. By this time, almost all the other leading social democrats who had remained in Germany were in prison, in a concentration camp, silenced, or dead. The leadership in exile proved to be an unsatisfactory substitute. Its uncompromising position had already alienated many of those comrades who had elected to stay in Germany in 1933, and it made matters worse in January 1934 by issuing the Prague Manifesto, which called for a radical policy of expropriation to destroy big business and the big landed estates, once Hitler had been overthrown. This was unpalatable to many local opposition groups, while failing to convince others that the party leadership had really shaken off the passivity and fatalism that had hampered its will to resist in 1932-33. Dissatisfied with what they saw as the party's feebleness, small, more radical groups acted independently, taking a variety of names such as the International Socialist Fighting League, the Revolutionary Socialists of Germany, or the Red Shock Troops, a purely Berlin organization. These in turn quarreled with other underground groups that remained loyal to the exiled leadership in Prague, disagreeing not only over policies, but also over tactics. In such circumstances, any idea of rousing the masses to outright opposition to the regime, the traditional goal pursued by underground movements in European history, was doomed to failure from the start. Finding a basis in the masses was almost impossible. The tattered remnants of labor movement culture that remained under the Third Reich were few and usually unimportant. The Nazi coordination of local associational life of all kinds had simply been too thorough. Rabbit breeding circles, gymnastic clubs, and similar groups that changed their names by dropping social democratic terms from their titles but kept the same leadership and membership as before, were quickly recognized for what they were and closed down by the police or the municipal authorities. The social democratic resistance was thus never able to expand beyond small, locally organized elite groups of activists. Moreover, the Nazi regime could not be convincingly portrayed, like the regimes of Metternich or Bismarck, as the representative of a tiny authoritarian elite. On the contrary, its rhetoric announced from the start that it intended to represent the people as a whole, mobilizing them in support of a new kind of state that would overcome internal divisions and create a new national community for the whole German race. This was a dispiriting fact with which social democratic activists quickly came to terms. It was probably loyalty to the memory of the social democratic-oriented trade unions that lay behind the mass abstentions that met the annual elections legally required of shop floor representatives in 1934 and 1935. There were so many blank or spoiled ballots that the results were kept secret in 1934 and 1935, and the process was abandoned thereafter. The Gestapo tracked down many of the Marxists who distributed leaflets urging a no vote in the plebiscite of August 19, 1934, arresting over 1,200 of them in the Rhine-Ruhr area alone. Massive waves of arrests of social democrats rolled over other parts of Germany, such as Hamburg. The issue of a special leaflet by the Social Democratic Resistance on May 1, 1935, prompted a further series of arrests. By the end of the year, the formal underground organization of the Social Democrats had been effectively destroyed. Yet, the sheer size of the party's former membership and the enduring power of its former cultural milieu and traditions ensured that hundreds of thousands of old Social Democrats remain loyal in their hearts to the fundamental values of their party. Loosely organized, informal, decentralized groups of social democrats continued throughout the rest of the Third Reich to keep these values and ideals alive, even though they could do nothing to put them into effect. A small number of radical social democrats, gathered since 1929 in a group that called itself New Beginning, took the view that the main prerequisite for a successful workers' resistance was the reunification of the German labor movement, whose bitter division between social democrats and communists they thought had opened the way to the rise of fascism. Its 100 or so members, backed by a rather large number of sympathizers, expended a great deal of effort in trying to bring the parties together, using tactics such as infiltrating communist cells and working to change the party's line from within. The organization's manifesto, written by its leader, Walter Lohenheim, and published in Carlsbad in August 1933, in an edition of 12,000, aroused some debate in resistance circles when it was secretly distributed in Germany. But Lohenheim concluded in 1935 that the prospects for success were so small that there was no point in carrying on. Although some members, like the future historian Francis Karsten, tried to continue, waves of arrests by the Gestapo soon crippled the remnants of the movement. Karsten himself went into emigration and began a doctorate on the early history of Prussia. Other small groups in exile and within the country worked along similar lines, including the International Socialist Fighting League and the Socialist Workers' Party of Germany, one of whose members was the young Willy Brandt, who left Germany for exile in Scandinavia and became mayor of West Berlin and then federal chancellor of West Germany after the war. All these groups, however, rejected the politics of both the major working-class parties as divisive and outmoded, without really developing any coherent political concept to put in their place. The hardline attitude of the communists made any idea of creating a united front quite impossible to fulfill. Since the end of the 1920s, the Communist Party of Germany had been following the ultra-left party line in Moscow, which damned the Social Democrats as social fascists and regarded them indeed as the main obstacle to a proletarian revolution. Nothing that happened in 1933 or 1934 changed this. In May 1933, the German Communist Party's Central Committee reaffirmed what the Comintern praised as the party's absolutely correct political line against social fascism. It said, "The complete exclusion of the social fascists from the state apparatus, the brutal suppression of the Social Democratic Party organization and its press, as well as our own, do not alter the fact that now, as before, they constitute the main social support of the dictatorship of capital." Critics of the ultra-left line and advocates of cooperation with the Social Democrats, such as Hermann Rommel and Heinz Neumann, had already been removed from the party leadership in 1932, leaving the ever-faithful Ernst Thälmann at least nominally in charge. Though he had in effect been out of action since his arrest and imprisonment immediately after the Reichstag fire in February 1933. "For the working class," trumpeted the leading German communist Fritz Heckert at the end of 1933, despite all the evidence, "there is only one real enemy. That is the fascist bourgeoisie and social democracy, its principal social support." Such grotesquely unrealistic views were not simply the result of unconditional obedience to Moscow. They also reflected the long legacy of bitterness between the two major working-class parties since the Revolution of 1918 and the murder of the communist leaders Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg by Free Corps units raised at the behest of the Social Democrats. In their turn, Social Democrats knew that the Bolshevik regime in Russia had murdered some thousands of its opponents, and that their counterparts there, the Mensheviks, had been among the first victims. Unemployment, which affected communists more than social democrats, had driven a further wedge between the two parties. Nobody raised the prospect of united action within either the Social Democratic Party or the Communist Party with any success in 1931 to 1934. The Social Democrats could boast a much larger membership than the Communist Party, over 1 million at the beginning of 1933, as against only 180,000 or so for the Communists. And their members tended to stay loyal to their party for longer than Communists did to theirs. However, years of purges and the repeated disciplining of internal dissidents had left the Communists well-disciplined and united, while a tradition of clandestine work and secret organization, more recent and more effective than that of the Social Democrats, ensured that illegal communist cells were quickly set up all over Germany once the shock of the first months of 1933 had passed. The party's lack of realism about the situation was, ironically, another positive factor. Believing fervently that the final collapse not only of Nazism but also of capitalism as a whole was now only just a matter of months away, communists saw every reason to risk their freedom and their lives in a struggle that would surely end before long in total victory for the proletarian revolution. Yet, what did that struggle consist of? For all the Nazis' alarmist propaganda in 1933 about the imminence of a violent communist revolution, the fact was that the reconstituted German Communist Party could do little more than its social democratic counterpart. There were a few acts of sabotage, and a handful of communists tried to obtain military information to feed to the Soviet Union. But the vast majority of the scores of thousands of communists active in the resistance could only concentrate on keeping the movement alive underground, ready for the day when Nazism fell, along with a capitalist system they thought sustained it. They held secret meetings, distributed illicit imported political propaganda, collected membership dues and produced and circulated crude mimeographed fly sheets and newsletters, sometimes in quite large numbers, in pursuit of their aim of reaching as many people as possible and rousing them to oppose the regime. They set up clandestine distribution networks for magazines and leaflets produced by the communist apparatus outside Germany and smuggled into the country by couriers. There was also extensive cooperation between the resistance within Germany and the leadership outside. The newspaper The Red Flag, for instance, was edited in exile, but printed in a number of centers within the country, including, for example, an illegal press in Zolligan-Oligs, which produced about 10,000 copies of each edition once or twice a month. In a few places, the communists staged secret demonstrations on May Day, running up red flags or the hammer and sickle banner on high buildings and daubing slogans on railway stations. Like the Social Democrats, the communists leafleted for a no vote in the plebiscite of August 19, 1934. There is no doubt that the communists were more active and more persistent than the Social Democrats in organizing resistance in the early years of the Third Reich. Apart from the greater commitment, some would say fanaticism, of its members, the Communist Party was also under instructions from its leadership in exile to maintain as visible a presence in Germany as possible. Couriers and agents came and went from Paris, Brussels, Prague, and other outside centers, often under assumed identities, constantly attempting to keep the movement going or to revive it where it had been destroyed. Raids and arrests were frequently followed by jauntily assertive mass leafleting to expose the brutality of the police and demonstrate the regime's failure to destroy the resistance. But such tactics proved the party's undoing, since they inevitably rendered it visible not just to workers but also to the Gestapo. The party's bureaucratic structure and habits also helped the police identify and track down its members, as branch treasurers and secretaries like Hans Pfeiffer in Dusseldorf, for example, meticulously continued to keep copies of letters, minutes of meetings, records of subscriptions, and lists of members, all of which proved invaluable to the regime when they fell into the hands of the police. The same problems that afflicted the Social Democrats also plagued the communists. Difficulty of communication with the exiled leadership. Destruction of the social and cultural infrastructure of the labor movement. Exile, imprisonment, or death of the most experienced and talented leaders. Despite the legendary discipline of the party, too, serious divisions soon emerged within the exiled leadership between an ultra-left majority that continued to pour venom on the Social Democrats and the Communist International, which recognized the scale of the defeat the party had suffered and eventually began to urge collaboration with Social Democrats in a popular front against fascism. In January 1935, the Communist International openly condemned the party's former policy as sectarian and began to tone down its revolutionary rhetoric. Sensing the way the wind was blowing, a growing minority amongst the German communists went along with the new Moscow line. They were led by Walter Ulbricht, the former Berlin communist leader, and Wilhelm Pieck, a long-term Reichstag deputy and companion of Liebknecht and Luxemburg in their final days, before their murder by the Free Corps during the Spartacus uprising of 1919. Alongside this ideological reorientation, the centralized structure of the party in Germany, so helpful to the Gestapo, was now dismantled and replaced with a looser organization in which the different parts were kept largely separate. The way finally seemed open to a united and effective working-class resistance against the Nazis. But it was all far too late. The local organizers and many of the rank and file of the communist resistance had spent too long fighting the Social Democrats to abandon their hatred now. When 7,000 workers paraded in Essen in the middle of 1934 to demonstrate at the grave of a communist who had died in prison, the local communist leadership made it clear that Social Democrats, against whom the deceased had always fought, would not be welcome. Moreover, Ulbricht, charged with bringing about a popular front of communists and Social Democrats in Germany from his position of exile in Paris, had a talent for antagonizing people. Some thought that he was being deliberately abrasive, so as to put the blame on the Social Democrats for the failure of a policy that he did not really support anyway. It also proved impossible to communicate the new party line to many activists within Germany, given the vigilance over couriers exercised by the Gestapo. The German Social Democrats, for their part, remained as suspicious of the Popular Front, which really did lead to genuine, if uneasy, cooperation in France and Spain, as they had been of the United Front, a well-known tactic of the communists to undermine them during the Weimar Republic. The legacy of bitterness sown in 1919 to 1923 proved too powerful for any real cooperation to come about in Germany. In any case, by the time the Popular Front policy was in full swing, both communist and social democratic resistance organizations had been severely damaged by the Gestapo. The mass arrests carried out in June and July 1933 obliged the resistance movement to regroup. But the Gestapo was soon on the track of the new organizations and began to arrest their members too. The experience of the Dusseldorf branch of the illegal communist resistance was probably not untypical. A great industrial center with a tradition of radicalism, Dusseldorf was a stronghold of the Communist Party, which won 78,000 votes in the Reichstag election of November 1932, 8,000 more than the Nazis, and more than twice as many as the Social Democrats. The mass arrests that followed the Reichstag fire decree on February 28, 1933, severely damaged the local party. But under the leadership of the 27-year-old Hugo Paul, it regrouped and put out a steady stream of leaflets and propaganda. In June 1933, however, the Gestapo seized the party's records and arrested Paul himself at the home of the man who printed the leaflets. Brutal interrogation revealed the names of further activists, and over 90 had been arrested by the end of July. The party's clandestine leadership in Berlin sent a series of replacements for Paul, changing them frequently to avoid discovery. And by the spring of 1934, the local organization had a membership of around 700, producing an internal newsletter in editions of 4,000 to 5,000 copies, and distributing leaflets by pushing them through letterboxes at night or scattering them from the top of high buildings such as the railway station, banks, cinemas, and hotels by means of a device known as a jumping jack. The party regarded the distribution of the bitingly sarcastic commentary on the Night of the Long Knives as a particular success. However, the Gestapo was able to turn a clandestine communist functionary, Wilhelm Gottner, into a double agent. And when he re-entered the local Communist Party after his release in 1934, arrests soon followed. 60 in the town's central ward, followed by 50 in the working-class district of Friedrichstadt. Other communists who were arrested and tortured committed suicide rather than betray their comrades. Yet despite the repression, the murder of Rome led to renewed optimism about the imminent collapse of the regime, and membership actually increased, reaching about 4,000 in the Lower Rhine and Ruhr districts combined. This did not last long. The growing centralization and efficiency of the Gestapo under Himmler and Heydrich soon led to further arrests. Most crucially, the entire secret national leadership of the Communist Party in Berlin was taken into custody on March 27, 1935. This left local and regional groups disoriented and leaderless, their morale further damaged by growing disillusion with the ultra-left policy pursued by the party since the late 1920s. Desertions and further arrests left the clandestine party organization in the Ruhr and Lower Rhine in tatters. It consisted of no more than a few isolated groups by the time the new district leader, Waldemar Schmidt, arrived in June 1935. He had little time to make his report to the exiled party leadership, however, since he too was very quickly arrested in his turn. A similar story could be told in virtually every other part of Germany. In Halle-Merseburg, for example, A police spy led the Gestapo to a meeting of the district leadership early in 1935. Those arrested were tortured to force them to reveal the names of other members. Documents were seized. There were more arrests, more torture. And eventually over 700 people were arrested, totally destroying the regional Communist Party organization and leaving the few remaining members completely demoralized. The party cadres were now politically paralyzed, not without justification, by mutual suspicion. Through careful information gathering, house searches, ruthless interrogation and torture of suspects, and the use of spies and informants, the Gestapo had succeeded in destroying the organized resistance of the Communist Party by the end of 1934, including its welfare organization, the Red Aid, which was dedicated to helping the families of prisoners and members who had fallen on hard times. From now on, only small, informally organized groups of communists could continue to meet, and in many places not even these existed. They more or less abandoned their earlier ambition of rousing the masses and focused instead on preparing for the time when Nazism would eventually fall. Of all the groups who held out against Nazism in the early years of the Third Reich, the communists were the most persistent and the most undaunted. They paid the greatest price as a consequence. Those communists who had sought refuge from repression in the Soviet Union fared little better than their comrades who remained in Germany. The gathering threat of fascism across Europe, the failures of agricultural collectivization in Russia and the Ukraine, and the travails and tribulations of forced industrial growth all induced a growing sense of paranoia in the Soviet leadership. And when one of the most prominent and popular of the younger generation of Bolshevik leaders, Sergei Kirov, was murdered with the obvious complicity of Bolshevik party officials in 1934, the Soviet leader Joseph Stalin began to organize a mass arrest of Bolshevik party functionaries, sparking a massive purge that quickly gained its own momentum. Soon, leading communist functionaries were being arrested and shot in their thousands, and made to confess fantastic crimes of subversion and treachery in widely publicized show trials. The purge spread rapidly down the party's ranks, where officials and ordinary members vied with each other in denouncing supposed traitors and subversives among their own number. The Gulag archipelago of labor camps, strung across the less hospitable parts of the Soviet Union, above all in Siberia, swelled to bursting with millions of prisoners by the late 1930s. From Stalin's acquisition of supreme power at the end of the 1920s to his death in 1953, it has been estimated that over 750,000 people were executed in the Soviet Union, while at least 2.75 million died in the camps. In this atmosphere of terror, fear, and mutual recrimination, anything out of the ordinary would become the pretext for arrest, imprisonment, torture, and execution. Contact with foreign governments, even previous residents in a foreign country, began to arouse suspicion. Soon the purges began to suck the German communist exiles into their vortex of destruction. Thousands of German communists who had sought refuge in Stalin's Russia were arrested, sent to labor camps, or exiled to Siberia. Over 1,100 were condemned for various alleged crimes, tortured by Stalin's secret police, and imprisoned in grim conditions in the labor camp for lengthy periods of time. Many were executed. Those killed included several members or former members of the party's Politburo. Heinz Neumann, the former propaganda chief whose advocacy of violence in 1932-33 the Politburo had vehemently rejected. Hugo Eberlein, a former friend of Rosa Luxemburg, whose criticisms of Lenin had not found favor in the Soviet Union. And Hermann Rommel, who had been incautious enough to say in 1933 that the Nazi seizure of power marked a defeat for the working class. Of the 44 communists who belonged to the Politburo of the German Party between 1920 and 1933, more were killed in Stalin's purges in Russia than died at the hands of the Gestapo and the Nazis in Germany. Enemies of the People. 1. In custody after his arrest for setting fire to the Reichstag on February 27th and 28th, 1933, the young Dutch anarchist Marinus van der Lubbe must have known that he would never leave prison alive. Hitler indeed had said as much. The culprits, he declared, would be hanged. But in saying so, he immediately ran into difficulties with the law. Hanging was the favored method of execution in his native Austria, but not in Germany, where decapitation had been the only method used for almost a century. Moreover, the German criminal code did not make arson punishable by death, unless it led to someone being killed, and nobody had died as a direct result of van der Lubbe's deed. Brushing aside the scruples of legal advisors and bureaucrats in the Reich Justice Ministry, the cabinet persuaded President Hindenburg to issue a decree on March 29, 1933, applying the death penalty provisions of the Reichstag fire decree of February 28th retroactively to offenses, including treason and arson, committed since January 31st, Hitler's first full day in office. As some newspaper commentators still dared to point out, this violated a fundamental principle of the law, namely that laws should not apply punishments retroactively to crimes that had not carried them when they were committed. If the death penalty had been prescribed for arson at the time of van der Lubbe's offense, then he might have been deterred from committing it in the first place. Now, nobody committing an offense could be sure what the punishment would be. Hitler and Goering were not just determined to see van der Lubbe executed. They also wanted to pin the arson attack on the German Communist Party, which they had effectively outlawed, on the basis of the claim that it was behind the attempt. So on September 21, 1933, it was not only van der Lubbe but also Georgi Dimitrov, the Bulgarian head of the Western European Bureau of the Communist International in Berlin, two of his staff, and the German Communist Reichstag floor leader, Ernst Torgler, who stood in the dock at the Reich Court in Leipzig to answer the charges of arson and high treason. Presiding over the proceedings was the conservative judge and former People's Party politician, Wilhelm Bunger. But Bunger, for all his political prejudices, was a lawyer of the old school and stuck to the rules. Dimitrov defended himself with ingenuity and skill and made Hermann Goering look a complete fool when he was called to the witness box. Combining forensic ability with impassioned communist rhetoric, Dimitrov managed to secure the acquittal of all the accused apart from van der Lubbe himself, who was guillotined shortly afterwards. Immediately rearrested by the Gestapo, the three Bulgarians were eventually expelled to the Soviet Union. Torgler survived the war and subsequently became a social democrat. The court's judgment was careful to conclude that the Communist Party had indeed planned the fire in order to start a revolution, and that therefore the Reichstag fire decree had been justified. But the evidence against Dimitrov and the other communists, it concluded, was insufficient to justify a conviction. The Nazi leadership was humiliated. The Nazi daily newspaper, the Racial Observer, condemned it as a miscarriage of justice. It wrote, "That demonstrates the need for a thoroughgoing reform of our legal life, which in many ways still moves along the paths of outmoded liberalistic thought that is foreign to the people." Within a few months, Hitler had removed treason cases from the competence of the Reich Court and transferred them to a special People's Court, set up on April 24, 1934. It was to deal with political offenses speedily and according to National Socialist principles, and the two professional judges in charge of cases were to be assisted by three lay judges drawn from the Nazi Party, the SS, the SA, and other similar organizations. After a period of rotating chairmanship, it was presided over from June 1936 by Otto Georg Tirak, a longtime Nazi born in 1889, who was appointed Saxon Minister of Justice in 1933 and vice president of the Reich Supreme Court 2 years later. Tirok was to prove a figure of major significance in the undermining of the judicial system during the war. He introduced a new, sharply ideological note into the court's already highly politicized proceedings. Meanwhile, preparations had been underway for the trial of the Communist Party leader Ernst Thälmann, which would set the seal on the regime's conviction of the communists for trying to start a revolutionary uprising in 1933. A dossier of charges was compiled, alleging that Thälmann had planned a campaign of terror, bombing, mass poisoning, and the taking of hostages. Yet the trial had to be postponed because of the lack of hard evidence. Thälmann's high profile as the former leader of one of Germany's major political parties ensured that over 1,000 foreign journalists applied for admission to the trial. This already gave the regime pause for thought. There was a distinct possibility that Thälmann might try to turn the trial to his advantage. A death sentence had been agreed in advance. Yet the experience of the Reichstag fire trial made the Nazi leadership, above all Goebbels, wary of putting on another big show trial. So in the end, the Nazi leadership considered it safer to keep Thälmann in protective custody, manacled and isolated, in the obscurity of a cell in the state prison at Moabit, in Berlin, then later in Hanover, and later still in Bautzen, without a formal trial. The Communist Party made the most of his imprisonment, retaining him indefinitely in the formal position of chairman. An attempt to spring him from jail in 1934, by communists dressed as SS men, was foiled at the last minute by the action of a Gestapo spy who had infiltrated himself into the rescue group. Under close observation, his correspondence with his family censored, Thälmann did not stand a chance of escape. He never came before a court and was never formally charged with any offense. He remained in prison, the object of repeated international campaigns for his release, organized by communists and their sympathizers across the world. Deprived of the chance to stage a show trial of Thälmann, the People's Court preferred initially at least to deal with less conspicuous offenders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.